Biohazard. And then we still got some of the familiar names, however, with the Mighty Unjust and Eye Scorpion going down there.
I am very excited for this winner's round two of games. I think we definitely have, especially for North America, I feel like we're definitely in a position that we get a lot of the same players week in, week out. It's just a question of how they'll change, right? Are they playing new characters? What have they learned in the last kind of week? Which, considering this week has been more on the new patch of the game, where, you know, again, not to sound like a broken record, but this is MK11 Ultimate. This is the biggest change to gameplay we have ever seen in MK11, where new characters, big patch, custom variations for every character are now legal. Like, there are so many new things from a gameplay standpoint that a week makes a big difference in terms of competition, whether it's community events, whether it's events like this, or whether it's the pro competition season 2 that we'll talk more about later on, that is coming up very soon actually as well in December. But this next match is going to be Illuminati versus Ice Scorpion. Illuminati has been absolutely being a menace with the Buzzsaw Kung Lao, one of the moves that is now tournament legal thanks to customs, and has completely changed the offense of what this character is capable of. It really has been a problem. We saw Derpy really dominate the day in the European side of the Open Series earlier with Buzzsaw Kung Lao, and that was Buzzsaw and Possessed Hat, whereas Illuminati tends to run Buzzsaw and Air Teleport. But again, there could be changes to that for all we know. And Ice Scorpion is playing the buff graded, or whatever he may call it. Although actually this time Illuminati is running the Buzzsaw and Guided Hat, so it's going to be just the ability to just change where the hat is going to make it a mid. That's really solid. Okay. Interesting.
I guess maybe that's a matchup specific thing, right? Like, was trying to look out for anything that Ice Scorpion was going to bring to the table and change it, because that's a bit different from the first match that we saw with Illuminati.
Now, I really do think that that is going to be the go-to for a lot of people. Is the, you will have your move that is like move or moves, like one or two that will be your, like, you will always have those, and then you'll have like almost like a utility slot where you'll have your main variation, which in this case could just be Buzzsaw, and then the other move is what do I need, and I'll have other variations made for that. However, Ice Scorpion is going to be looking at this upgraded 2.0, the leap, the shrapnel, the grenade launcher. We've already seen it today, and we will continue to see it today, as it is oh so popular in the American Open Series.
Yeah, I think we'll see it more than just today. I think it'll happen a couple other times after that, week after week.
Once or twice, perhaps. As long as it continues to be as scary as it is right now, we will absolutely see it continue. I have no doubt in my mind.
Actually, I'm pretty surprised that Ice Scorpion walked forward there, because he had two puddles down for the fire pits, and Illuminati was unable to walk behind them because of the fact that the camera is unable to move if the other person's not going to. So I'm surprised that he moved forward and got him out of it. I would have just took the free damage.
I did not want to interrupt, but I cannot believe that much health went down. So that right, Ice Scorpion put down two of those pools on the floor, and then a very common thing he will do is, remember what I said before about damage over time going through last breath if it's like something you can technically avoid? Jackie has the grease kick, which is the, you know, multiple kick special attack. That locks you in place for about a second and a half, and it hits multiple times, so it's chip damage. If that happens to you while you're standing in the fire, your health absolutely melts on block. So, he died. He just dropped his hat. Literally just dropped his bloody hat.
That is the perfect way to for a match to end. He's trying to throw the hat, but he's just like, oh, I can't do it.
It's like, it even happens to Shaolin Warriors. You ever just try to throw something, like, you know, you're throwing a baseball and you farm it somehow, and it's like, don't worry, it happens to everyone. But the way that first round ended, where there's fire underneath you, Illuminati blocked all but the last hit of that kick and then landed in the fire after taking damage from the kick and then died at like 20% health. I can't believe that happened the way it did. But I mean, I can absolutely believe it, but I'm still in shock.
I mean, that's one of the reasons why this is the buff graded, right? Is so you can be able to get that in the first place. You didn't have access to the grenade launcher before, so it was only just the normal amount of health that you're getting down. But now it's both at the same time. It's
well, it's honestly, it's one of the many reasons why so many people consider this one of the strongest variations in the game, because what made upgraded Jackie so good, because upgraded Jackie was Bionic Bounce, Enhanced Air Blast, and instead of Grenade Launcher, it was the Air Ground Pound, which would basically slam her to the floor as a low, and an MK, jumping attacks are overheads on the way down. So that would kind of be a mix-up where it was like overhead air attack or ground pound on the way down. And it was unsafe on block, but it was a pain. Ooh, speaking of pain, crushing blow to the face. That would do it.
But, I didn't want to interrupt, but I winced from that. Anytime I see Rush Punch Crushing Blow, I just fear for the other player.
You get used to it, don't worry. You kind of eventually just get desensitized to it.
I guess that's true.
But no, he's just wobbling the hat around. The control, he was holding that.
Yeah, I think that's one of the reasons why he went towards this. But this is the first time we're seeing it.
I do wonder if we see more of that from Illuminati. I think he's trying to figure this out on the fly. Nice pickup. Ooh, okay, just getting raw. And in the corner, the spin does connect. Oh, there it is. And there's the round.
Off, yeah.
But while we load into this round, just to really kind of hammer in why this variation is so good for Jackie, though, one of the biggest changes she had in the patch was her damage options off the leap and the enhanced shrapnel. They actually took a damage reduction by quite a significant amount. But the grenades are so much damage. But look at that, 370 damage. That is like pre-patch Jackie damage. Like, the damage of the grenade launcher seems to completely undo the damage nerf.
Oh, I mean, yo, Kung Lao is about to answer right back with 380 of his own after ducking that throw. He wouldn't have got access to that if he didn't duck that throw. So,
okay, I mean, Kung Lao damage has always been quite chunky. The scary thing about Buzzsaw is you take his chunky damage, and then you throw the Buzzsaw in the end as massive damage, but also like an ender that's like plus 50 or something on hits. It's quite a lot. It's a decent knockdown, to say the least.
Okay. No real ability to stop the leap, though, thanks to that Amplify. It's just so scary.
Yeah, it's the constant mind game. She leaps at you, you want it out in the air, but the second you're out in the air, she goes for the air blast, and boom, your button loses. Hang on a minute!
Okay.
Scorpion. Ooh, breakaway's late. I like it. Try to breakaway late. Oh, never mind. Gonna lose. Brutality? No, doesn't have it. But no, yeah. I like the idea to break late there for Ice Scorpion is... There are certain points you can break combos that make the attacker punishable on hit. And Kung Lao's spin is one of them. If you break right as he goes for certain heights of spin or amplified spin, and you happen to break right there, you get a free hit on it. And this is a game where counter hits lead to crushing blows, punishes lead to crushing blows. So you will sometimes accept 90% of a combo's damage so you can break away late and punish them on hit. But if the player knows you're doing that, then they'll just do something else instead. Eternal mind game.
Yeah, and I mean, he was gonna have to break away no matter what because that combo was gonna kill if he did not. So you gotta break away, and then you choose the best spot to break away. It's good awareness.
Making the best of a bad situation, right? That's the whole point.
Yeah, exactly. Unfortunately, it didn't end up working out as Illuminati did take that game. So I believe that is the that's 1-1 now. I already forgot.
It is 1-1. But again, Illuminati is a player that we'd seen before, but not very much. But it was always Kung Lao. So the fact that we're now seeing him bring again this buzzsaw. Oh, and the reactionary dive kick. That was clean.
That was amazing. I was not ready for that, but I mean, Illuminati was. Good lord.
The dive kick with Kung Lao is actually on paper one of the fastest moves in the game in terms of startup, but can only do it from a jump. But if you're already in the air and they do literally anything, it's like, oh, okay, cool. Dive kick.
Oh, great catch on the jump out right there. Yeah, he was trying to air to air him, I think, on that one. But yeah, he's still in that puddle. That damage is adding up. Getting the wake up 3. Okay. Maybe
there's a punish.
Get up roll. Oh my goodness.
Oh no, ground fight, that's it, it's over. I was just about to say, if Ice Scorpion can find any space to get ground fire down, it is going to be finished, and that is it right there. Now there's some, a little bit. Illuminati, I like the way he's backing off here. Get that space out of the hat.
Unfortunately for him, that fire did give him a little bit of extra damage on that, but okay, the buzzsaw, full conversion because of it.
Decent damage too.
Damage.
Oh no.
Crushing. Yeah, there's immediate breakaway though, doesn't want to have to deal with it, and because of that, he doesn't actually have to deal with the puddle in the corner too. That actually was probably best case scenario there.
Jumping into the buzzsaw, yeah, that's not gonna work. I wonder if Ice Scorpion can find it. He's got the fatal blow. Nope, that's not enough. Yeah, that's gonna be death. Kung Lao, the chunky damage coming through once more. And the corner pressure too.
Final round, fight.
That really is the scariest thing about Kung Lao's damage across the board, though, is almost any touch is going to... Not only just the damage, but he always ends in a good knockdown. So is he going to throw? Is he going to go for a strike? Oh, it's looming in. The threat.
Yeah, that dash punch, though, was a really smart option to be able to get out of the corner right there. Very smart, just to make things happen. But even the fire on the ground is not helping him out versus this buzzsaw right now. Buzzsaw just seems to be infallible sometimes.
But just look at the fire underneath Illuminati. Ice Scorpion wasn't anywhere near him and still had corner game because of the fire. Hang on. Hang on. Illuminati, I like that. Meaty Buzz Saw. Oh, nice. The pickup!
That was incredible. Oh, if he had gotten that down one to confirm kill, I would have been...
That was so good. That was so good. Instant as well. That was instant jump too. That was deliberately to stop that. Illuminati, hang on a minute. Are we going to be talking about... You know, we've been talking about potential upsets, but this would absolutely be one if Illuminati could take out Ice Scorpion with this buzzsaw. I think it was less than a week ago we saw Illuminati versus Biohazard where... He actually double eliminated Biohazard 3-0 in both sets they played of the day with this buzzsaw variation. Whereas now we're seeing the guided hat, then it was air teleport. I think we're really seeing how the meat of the variation is the buzzsaw. Because we didn't really see much of the air teleport last week, and we're not really seeing much of the guided hat this week. It's about just what you want, you know, what you think is appropriate. I wonder if we're ever going to see, like, buzzsaw and... Actually, I was going to say Buzzsaw and Z-Hab. I think they might actually collide. Yeah, they collide. I don't think you can put them together. Never mind. Analysis stopped dead in its tracks.
And also Buzzsaw taking up the two different slots in the, yes. in the variation is kind of a big deal. But I mean, hey, it's worth the two slots in my personal opinion. Because a second ago,
sure.
we have seen Buzzsaw be just loom there and sit there when Jackie does leap into Amplify. Because like the Buzzsaw sits there because she has to fall into it no matter what.
Oh, hello. That's a decent amount of damage, too. Ice Scorpion caught himself. I don't think he really cares. I like the way Illuminati is trying to safely navigate towards as well. Doesn't want to just walk in.
Oh, there it is again. The strength of that Buzzsaw catching the get-up roll. Just making it so that it's really difficult to change your defensive options up when Buzzsaw is there. Great breakaway to stay
especially
alive.
Especially considering the person doing the buzzsaw, like they can hold it, they can amp it, they can move it, they can let it go straight away. Like, so many options, but that's going to be the round for Ice Scorpion.
That was such a smart drop of the fire pool, because he recognized that he needed to get out of the fire pool that was far away. So he was like, if I pop one right here and then back up, he's stuck between two. So he either dies or he's stuck in a situation where I can do anything I want.
Uh-oh, that's going to be an 18% throw? Oh no, it does a bit more. Actually, near enough the same. But it does 18% on a back throw, but my mistake. 1% less for the forward. Oh!
Yeah, that's the strength of that fire pool.
Oh my goodness! Uppercut on the way up, speaking of which, and yeah. Oh, doesn't chase down the roll. I think that was the idea. That forward one just off the mark a little bit.
Standing in the fire pit, though.
Oh no,
take the damage
oh no!
Throwing. This might actually be the big detriment and kill him because of it, yeah! Super unfortunate right there to throw in the middle of the fire pit. You take all that damage regardless of being in throw state.
Well, that's the damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. I mean, what are you going to do? Just like not take your free damage? Or if you let your foot off the gas and they move out of the corner and you've lost positioning? It's one of those dangerous scenarios, right? Any of these moves that you plant them on the floor and the opponent can just die by standing on them without the resources to worry about, like... Eren Acid, there's you know, Kano Fire. That there are so many examples of this kind of damage over time that, I mean, they're just such a dangerous threat to have. Least of all on a character like Jackie. But you know, this is what the character is capable of doing. Now we are going into the last match, game 5, no less. Guaranteed, Illuminati will finish the set and get the upset over Ice Scorpion, or Ice Scorpion continue to reign supreme. Looking unstoppable in MK11 Ultimate so far. Until now, potentially. Who knows? There's definitely been plenty of Game 5s Ice Scorpion has been in since the start of Ultimate. But you know, we are at a new week, a new day, and a Game 5 secured.
Illuminati has been playing at that level without question to be able to make another upset happen. If this is an upset, that would be our second upset of the day. So, I mean, hey, you know, throw escape right now just to start it out. It's already hard enough to deal with those Amplify. We're going to go for the Buzzsaw. Yeah, he was trying to make it so that teleport was going to be much safer. But however, whatever reason, Ice Scorpion was just ready for it with the jump.
I feel like it's almost like Illuminati goes for the teleport when things aren't looking so good. So now things are game 5. This is like high stress, high tension. Those kind of like more dangerous strategies that are higher risk but more unexpected might be a bit more likely now as, oh my goodness, Illuminati walks back into the lingering after effects of a single flame, and now it's match point for Ice Scorpion.
definitely looking difficult. I feel like Ice Scorpion's flame placement have been some of the best I've ever seen, to be honest with you. But there's the buzzsaw to catch that leap again. Mentioned it a little bit earlier, and it finally came back into play.
Look at the patience. Illuminati not even trying to add the air at this point, just accepting the fact that the leaps are going to happen. It's just a question of staying alive. As long as you don't get hit by the jump in, you'll be okay.
There's that leap, and yeah, again, just accepting, right? Unfortunately, not able to tech the throw here. Big damage on the forward. Okay. Yeah, get that buzzsaw damage wherever you can.
Oh, almost two hats on screen at once there.
How does that even work? He only has one. I don't understand.
The power of the Shaolin, my friend.
I guess when you have a mystical ancestor and a Shaolin monk at the same time, it's you just get to do stuff that's not normally possible.
It's their secret techniques. If they told you, they'd have to kill you.
Well, I mean, with that hat, I don't want to die by that way. That looks very painful.
He is content to make sure it's how the match ends, though. As we see it, no fatal blow.
He tried to stop the leap with the up two. The jumping two, but he wasn't able to get it in time. The Amplify hit him beforehand. He still got the throw, so we are now on set point for both players, and I feel like that buzzsaw play in the last round was the only thing he could go to at this point. He has to make it work.
And the problem is he's kind of at that perfect sweet spot. He can't sit there in the corner. He is just melting for standing there. He's lost almost half of his life bar, and he's barely been touched. Just the fire, constant threat. And as soon as Ice Scorpion is getting the bump, I mean, look at this! Where do you stand?
That's why you see him running forward. He cannot take fire damage anymore. He's already lost half of his health due to it.
As long as he keeps... Oh, that would have been really nice. As long as he keeps full screen, he'll be okay, because it doesn't quite cover there, but Kung Lao doesn't have amazing options there either. But this has been a very peculiar last round.
Of course, okay, the Amplify gets the throw. Yeah, he just doesn't want to take that extra damage of the back throw, because I haven't seen him tech forward once.
Oh! I think he's dead. I think he's dead. Oh, Illuminati. He just went for one risk too many in that moment. He had the fatal blow. If he could find that one hit, it would have been the end. But Ice Scorpion instantly ready with that crushing blow uppercut. And that was going to seal the deal. Ice Scorpion stops the set from going too far. And he gets another winner's finals guaranteed. I mean, I really feel like this is becoming the most expected result. Is Ice Scorpion winner's finals. He has continued to be the scariest player in customs for North America. He really has just had the right option. And also, not through lack of trying, I feel like I've seen Ice Scorpion play mainly game fives. He's had mainly game five sets since we saw Ultimate come out, and we're seeing him now with the customs option. It's like, he just has that clutch factor. We know he goes down to game five all the time against loads of different people, Might and Just especially. I think he's had like four game five matches against Unjust alone in like the last week. And he always seems to be the one to clutch them out. And that really has just said a lot for his composure and his ability to kind of keep it together when the chips are down. And now he's secured himself another winner's finals. That's third place guaranteed. That's minimum $100. And we'll see more from my Scorpion quite shortly. GG's. But we must swiftly move on to our next winner's side match, winner's round two of the Mighty Unjust versus Titanium Tigers. So, as a Titanium Tigers fan, as he is from, you said Oregon, right?
Oregon, yeah. It's on the west coast of the States. So
as a general thing, we mainly know Titanium Tigers as an online player. Yep. So, when you see him in like when you say he's like a local player, do you mean like he attends local events, or is he like within the space in the online
when
world?
When we had local events, Titanium Tigers would show up when they were able. Obviously not every time you can make it to every event, you know, of course, but yes, Titanium Tigers did make it to events when they were able. I believe Titanium Tigers won the first one they came out to. The second event after that, they unfortunately went down to a player that you might remember, Kratos, who's also in Oregon, who doesn't really play MK11 right now, but Titanium Tigers has been, you know, one of our better players for sure.
Brilliant. Well, we're seeing him now today in the Open Series, taking a 3-0 win of a Biohazard to start things off for him today. Really, honestly, quite the debut. Biohazard was trying out a new Nightwolf variation that we haven't seen him play before, but he is definitely a player that does not shy away from playing new characters in a strong way. And Titanium Tigers was playing the Cetra on there, so I imagine we could see that. I know Titanium Tigers is definitely known for playing a tremendous amount of characters, so I'm not at all surprised to see he has the Cetron, because I'm pretty sure I remember seeing him play Cetron even before Customs. But definitely a solid player. And you tend to find that in players, when they do play a lot of different characters at once, they eventually kind of like, they pick up characters a lot faster than you might think. They might be able to swap seamlessly between characters in at the same time without those kind of problems. And Unjust is a bit similar to that. So I imagine we could definitely have ourselves a bit of a, I would say counterpick fest, but I don't know if there really exists such a thing for certain characters right now. I don't know if Cetrion has that hard counter. I don't know if Jackie has that hard counter. And normally that's what you'd see if there are those established characters, or even now specific moves that might cause them a headache. I just don't think the game has developed with Customs to the point that we know what that is yet. So I think for now it's going to be comfort above all else.
I wonder if I feel like Cetrion is more of a guarantee for me personally on Titanium Tiger side, but Mighty Unjust I feel like is more of a toss-up in terms of character pick. But I really don't think counterpick war might be out of the question, regardless of the fact that these characters are, you know, pretty strong, obviously, and don't really have a hard counter. Hard counters are difficult to come by in this day and age, especially when you have any variation that you can pick up, right? If you run into a character that, you know, usually kind of obliterates another one, maybe a different variation of the equipment might help you out a little bit.
I think so. I think that's where we will eventually see the game goes. I would like to say sooner rather than later, but I think it depends on just how dominant some of these characters end up being. The biggest problem with the counterpick war right now, and it's funny to say out loud, but so Hidden Cursor, right? Hidden Cursor is a big thing in this game between players that play a lot of characters. And it's a game where you pick a character and then you pick a variation. And if you've gone Hidden Cursor, it's all gone. So you don't see yourself pick, you don't see yourself pick a variation. We have had players sometimes, it's very rare, but it has happened enough that I'll laugh about it, where they'll Hidden Cursor and they'll pick the wrong character and the wrong variation. So they end up with something that they do not mean to pick. Now there is 8 variations to pick from, because it gives you, when you pick a character in competitive, it gives you the 3 tournament variations, and then you're up to 5 customs that you've made yourself in addition. So if you're hiding your cursor, you not only have to know where your character is, which is the least difficult thing, you have to know exactly which of the 8 variations you are scrolling to, which might not be the one that you want if you have them right next to each other. But I digress. We might not see that be a problem. Who knows? Maybe I'm giving the players far too little credit.
Hey, I don't think hidden cursor would be too crazy. Okay, so it's new. Okay, so going for the Cybot. This is a character we saw a lot before the new ability to play any variation you wanted from Unjust. We saw, I feel like, Noob Cybot a lot more from Unjust than most other characters at the tail end of things.
This was definitely a case where Unjust was known for playing a lot of characters, but Noob Cybot was his real go-to comfort. Like, I would say that even with the amount of characters he played, I would still consider Unjust to be one of the scariest, if not the scariest, Noob Cybot players that are out there. He had, and he only played Seeing Double, right? And Noob Cybot is another character that benefits a lot from these new moves, because a lot of people picked Seeing Double just for the Shadow Slide, and that was it. But now, you can go Shadow Slide, the Air Tele Slam, but replace the useless unblockable projectile that never hits anyone with Launching Teleport, and now you have tremendous damage output on good reactions or good punishes. However, we can't talk about Customs without bringing up Kotal Kahn.
Yes.
And Titanium Tigers has definitely played Kotal Kahn a little bit, and his character is quite scary now, to say the least.
Round one. Well, I mean, especially with that Ray of Light, I don't know if that's... forgive me if I get this wrong, but is that Ray of Light in every variation? Is that like a staple move that he has? Okay, it is a base move. Yeah. So that Ray of Light is incredibly dangerous. It doesn't matter which variation you're in, but for this one, he's also got the pillar statue.
Yeah, so the totems are the real meat and potatoes of Kotal Kahn. He has up to 4 totems. Most of them can only be equipped one at a time. Ooh, the counter poke. The only exception is you can equip, there's a black totem that is damage reduction, and there's the blue one that is damage amplification. So in this variation, he has the command grab, which is an unblockable mid grab, so you can't duck it. That right there.
There it is, yeah.
And it amps his damage when he amplifies it. So it does, and you can side switch. It gives him a lot of damage output. That right there, the Grand Discus, it makes everything safe on block, and it hits off near enough everything now. And he's got that damage totem. So this is going to be a Kotal Kahn. It's not very flashy, but when he hits you, he is going to hit incredibly hard. There it is. Now that beam, that is universal. And if he's standing in it, he heals. And if you're in it, you get hurt. And it's a lot of damage, no less.
And that move's been kind of a staple since Kotal was introduced, so it's been showing up good for that character, and there's that discus. He tried to jump out, but, you know, it was meant to simply make the block string safe, and then it ended up not mattering and actually just caught him.
Well, it's scarier as well, because it heals and does damage in a percentage value, not a set value. And he has 1,100 health, so he has more health than everyone else in the game. He's got the most health. So when you really amp that up, and especially if you've got the damage totem, that really causes quite an issue in the grand scheme of things. Ooh, normal throw, but the dark and punish just built the bar back. Oh no, Unjust, he's going for the optimal. Just mistimed it, unfortunately.
Okay, totem's out.
Now, uh-oh. The second there's three, you have to be careful.
He's gonna be doing that damage.
Oh!
Oh my god!
And the chip damage. He's doing like 5% chip on projectiles.
Oh, on the break. Nice!
Oh my god!
I wonder if he knew that was gonna be a breakaway, because, you know, that does break armor.
So that was absolutely something you would do anyway, but okay. The fact that the breakaway was there is like icing on the cake. So in MK11, there's a really interesting tech that you can do in the game for everyone but Mileena and Rambo, because for some reason their jump kicks don't work the same way as everyone else's. But when you do if you cancel into a special move from a jump kick, mm-hmm. The special move will come out when you land on hit, but not on block. So if you do jump kick into a standing special, on block, nothing comes out, you just get the jump kick, and on hit, you get jump kick into special move. If the special move reaches off of a jump kick on hit, it's guaranteed damage, because a jump kick will hit, special move hits, decent chunk, right? It's a built-in option select, and it's very powerful. If that move that connects off a jump kick every time is one that crushing blows on armor break, you are in for a great time. And Kotal Kahn has exactly that. It's that upward sword strike. It's so fast, it's got an amazing hitbox, and the crushing blow damage is monstrous, especially from a jump kick. And that's what we saw right there. It really changed the game.
And that time he didn't even have the totem up too, so it wasn't amplified damage. He just did that much damage, which was about 30% of his health or more.
It is scary knowing that wasn't even close to the most it can do. Really, but that's just the way the cookie crumbles. But this variation, very good. I like the idea of this variation, because if you get the damage totems up, ooh, nice reaction. If you do find yourself getting the damage totem up, like, everything on block is going to either be a tick throw for a quarter life command grab, or safe on block disc for like 5% damage on block. I like this idea from Titanium Tigers. This is so good.
You mentioned it yourself. Oh, nice parry on the Shadow Tackle. Unfortunately, it's not going to allow for any sort of whip punish, but I mean, hey, at least he got in. Great.
Oh no, we missed it.
Okay, the mid, get that health back.
The second hit of that mid string is a restand, so that is the bit you want. Ooh, hang on a minute.
Amplify, ooh. Look at the damage.
If we just had been hit by a single hitting special move that does quarter of your life. Ooh. That would have seen it again.
When you get those three totems on deck, one, it, you know, maybe it's passable damage. Two, okay, it's starting to get a little scary. Three, I feel like I just died.
Oh, actually, no, he's alive. That would have been death. Oh, now he pushes him into the sunray. I love that. That was so smart from Tigers. He saw how much damage Unjust had left, and he immediately switched sides to try and push him into it. Very smart.
Yeah, and he just went for nice and safe little pokes that push back enough. He was like, there's no reason for me to take the risk. I just need to push him into the sunray, and we're good. Okay, gets the confirm here. Amplify.
Oh.
Wow, short hop to get over it. Or at least, I guess maybe he was just out of range, not over it.
I think maybe it's just also all short hop attacks are overheads too, so when you're against someone that's trying to threaten you with mid command grabs on block, just any extra layer to that mix up make your opponent more uncomfortable. Ooh, clone coming out though. Totem one, disc, totem two, there it is. Totem three! Oh no.
Oh, hey, didn't good get, hit. Wasn't able to get the confirm after the air to air, so he wasn't able to get good damage right there, and in fact, Mighty Unjust is able to make it happen right there. Fatal Blow is on deck, so one hit could just completely make this Titanium Tiger.
If Unjust gets hit into Fatal Blow, it's over. Kotal's Fatal Blow does a lot of damage. Yeah,
okay, just safety. To keep it safe. Oh, there's the whip punish! Yeah, he had been fishing for that whip punish pretty much the whole game. You saw so many walkbacks into that move right there, and eventually it finally worked out with the Fatal Blow of all things. Incredible decision from Titanium Tigers, and he is up 2-0 at this point.
No, absolutely. I mean, we had iScorpion almost get hit by the upset against Luminati, but able to clutch things out. Now, on the flip side, Tigers. If we talked about the hypotheticals of maybe seeing Tigers 3-0 Biohazard, and then if he had to fight Unjust, which we knew was the case then defeating Unjust, and then potentially fighting iScorpion Winners Finals for, like, the ultimate North American Open Series gauntlet. We are kind of in the process of seeing that exact thing happen, Abonic. Like, we are on the way, unless Unjust can figure something out. Because the problem is now, this is a really bad situation for Unjust, because... Okay, so we're seeing the spawn. The problem he's going to have now, though, is Titanium Tigers is much like Unjust, that he plays a ton of characters. And whatever you play now, you have to feel confident you can take out anything Tigers can throw at you in three matches, you know, without falling in between. Now, we are seeing the return of... This is basically the tried and true, the one spawn variation. So, you know, this was the one before, the Charging Hell spawn and the Glide. And even though a lot of spawn players were talking about the potential for creativity in customs, we're still kind of only really seeing this competitively. But again, Tigers with the footsies, that forward two, advancing mid, so good.
This is one of those situations where Titanium Tigers definitely knows how far forward two is going to go, and he is literally looking for any button that you could possibly press to be able to whip punish it.
Well, you can really fish for it too, because this variation... Oh, hang on a minute. Hello.
Huge damage. Okay, yeah, break away. Hurt. I understand. I completely understand.
Ooh, hang on, there's the restand. Then we're going to go from here, the sweep. Now that right there, you can really fish for that forward too, because on block, you're going to turn it into the disc, and on hit, you could do literally whatever you want. So you don't have to worry about them being point blank range or being minus, because, I mean, look at that pushback. That's not a bad situation to be in. Oh, the pickup! Fatal blow. No, he definitely tried it.
He got the interactable on this one at the very least, so he's still got a chance to make it happen, but they're so close in life for both of them that anything will kill just like this! Amplify to finish it off.
That was perfect. Tigers, that was the perfect option right there. Unjust, he missed the fatal blow confirm and made the best of it with the grab interactable, but it wasn't enough.
I guess at the very least he's got fatal blow for this round or the next one, depending, but the totems are out, so big damage. Look at the chip on just the normal.
No, it really is crazy, because chip damage is a big deal in Mortal Kombat across the board, but least of all when you're actually apping your damage. Oh no, speaking of damage, in the sun rain!
Look at
what?
Two totems in the sun ray and the throw.
I did not just see 380 damage on a command grab. My eyes deceive me that I did not see that. He tried it again, cheeky.
I can't believe it. I think we're in the same fever dream then, because I feel like I saw it too.
Oh my god, and three totems. Don't get hit by a grab for the love of all things holy.
At this point, you can't get hit by anything.
Wake up button, so we found it. Yeah, actually, no, he's alright. Second bar, fatal blow. No, he's just cashing out. Oh no, wake up, fatal blow, and the punish. Okay, Tigers definitely trying to stop the momentum before it even had chance to build. Didn't work, and just still alive. Okay. Abonic, that was a 380 damage grab, wasn't it? I'm not lying to myself. My eyes saw that.
You're there, I'm not gonna gaslight you. That was a 380 damage grab. That happened. This is real life. He had two totems and... Well, think about that, that was only two totems. If there was a third one, that could have been more than 380.
Oh no, I don't want to have nightmares tonight. We can stop the conversation now. Oh, there it is. Look at the damage. Now, the fact that Unjust, and again, that reversal fatal blow. Tigers. Okay, that shows me, with the crushing blow punish, that shows me Tigers does not want Unjust to get any momentum. Because both times Unjust looked like he was finally in control, Tigers responded without hesitation with just a raw super. And that shows me I want to end this now, because if you draw this out and win this game, that's a problem.
Yeah, that's why I'm making round, that. In the second round, it seemed less desperation and more, if I hit this, I win. If not, okay, I have another round. Yep. In the second one, that definitely smelled of desperation and trying to stop Mighty Unjust from doing anything at all, or at least changing the tide back, because Mighty Unjust took, what, two hits that entire game? That entire last round?
Yeah, it was a lot more dominant. Now, what does Tigers do? We did talk about the potential for him to change away, but the question is, what is it? Because in this kind of scenario, you will see it as, oh, Tigers can just pick whatever he wants, right? The problem with that is if this pick is not correct, and Unjust wins. We are tied up. We are 2-2. There is no longer an advantage to have. It's gone. Mm-hmm. Now, Geras is not really a bad choice. You know, you can't really go wrong with Geras. One of the most consistent characters in the game in terms of he's always going to be good, always going to be something strong about him. Now, what's this variation? Bed of Spikes, Quicksand, and... Ah, I see. So, this is Infinite Warden Plus. So, the Bed of Spikes and the Quicksand for confirms and decent kind of neutral options with punishment, which is big against Spawn. Shifting Sand. This is a very strange move where he just creates some quicksand underneath you, and it drags you to the middle of it. It's like a wide thing on the floor that if the opponent is in it, it pulls them towards it. So yeah, it really messes with damage. It's like messes with jumps, messes with movement. It is super weird.
I've actually seen setups with Shifting Sands where you can make it so that the opponent is punishable when they hit you because of it pushing back. That it makes them whip into the second part of their string, and then Geras gets to do whatever he wants afterwards.
Yeah, no, it's huge. Fujin has something similar. Oh, he's already whiffed it to get the KB. That's huge. There it is. Yep, that right there.
Yep.
Now, this is such a strange attack.
Just gonna keep setting it up. Yeah, it's been paying off so much mileage right now. Yeah, and that was actually punished because of that. Because it was out.
It made him punish. It made him whiff. It pulled him out of the range for it to connect. That was so bizarre. I love it, and I hate it.
Speaking and it'll happen, I guess. You know, it just comes to fruition after you talk about it.
Now, okay, we're seeing Unjust get a lot more aggressive now. Less of these standing buttons and more about, okay, I'm just going to move myself in and not worry about this. Oh, there it is again. He got knocked back so far. And gone again. Oh, no. The KB's already gone on that, though, so doesn't have to worry about it anymore.
Not nearly as much damage, but oh, there it is. Catching again thanks to those sands. It's paying off so much mileage, Mustard. This is incredible.
It really is. No, it's absolutely disgusting. There it is again. Oh, right at the edge, but the charge gets through. I'm kind of surprised that Unjust opted to go for the charge, considering what was behind him, but I think he knew he was out of range. Oh, both bars. He is in serious trouble. Cash out that damage, Tigers. And there's the anti-breakaway. So smart. Oh,
short hop.
The knee to the face. Tigers. That is the first time that I have seen Shifting Sand, used in a tournament since Customs, and that is one of the moves that I remember seeing before Customs were officially a thing. Because yeah, a lot of us in the community will experiment, right? You know, we work or we're involved in competitive, but custom moves were this big unexplored part of the game that it always felt like there was the rest of the game kind of hidden away behind these moves. And yeah, we give them a look, we see what's possible. Even though tournament variations were the standard for the whole time, there were still like community events and charity events here and there that might do customs as like an experiment or, you know, something a little bit different. This move was always a move that people would talk about as, this move's a problem, and if ever it's allowed in tournament, it's going to be a problem. I think I'm definitely believing that. Even though it was just one match, it was enough for me to go, so that's what it does.
Yeah, because I you know only dabble in MK11, you know I'm not super knowledgeable. I'd only very less often seen that in random Twitter clips, right? I've been like, okay, yeah, you know, now that we're all allowed to use variations, this is what the potential of the mood could do, right? But because I only dabble in it, I wasn't sure how true that would actually be when matches happened. I feel like that shows that it was completely true. It's completely possible, and especially against Spawn, it seemed like he didn't really have a ton of options to be able to deal with that move in particular. Like, maybe he could jump and glide, right? But, like, glide would leave him to anti-air.
I really think that was a perfect choice against Spawn specifically, because he kind of stands still and has a lot of recovery on his moves. So if you make him whiff when he doesn't normally, you are going to kill him a lot easier than you would a lot of other characters. So I definitely think kudos to Tigers for that pick. But no, it is like you say, though, right? You know, you see moves go on Twitter or whatever, and you know how it is in the FGC. Something will come out, and you'll see these hypothetical training mode, and it's a combo that will never hit, and it requires all this crazy stuff that will never happen, and it looks cool, but you can't help but think, yeah, but is that really a problem? This move, I think, is a case where it's like, okay, yeah, it actually might be. And we'll see. I know there are a decent amount of Geras players around, especially in North America. The Geras has always been a very North American character, so I guess time will tell. But I would love to, before we go to this next break, as we get our winners finals underway, I want to talk to those of you at home about some very exciting news that has recently been announced in the space of competitive Mortal Kombat 11, and that is the MK Pro Competition Season 2 has officially been announced, starting December 2020, yes, that is this month, to May 2021. You're going to be able to take part in free-to-enter online cups as part of the second year of Pro Competition official events in MK11. There are three leagues across North America, the Intercontinental Combat Returns, as well as Liga Latina, with multiple sub-regions in each league. So much of the world is as covered as possible for a total prize pool of $60,000. Sign up yourself, go to compete.playstation.com. These are free to enter, and the vast majority of the world is covered. So there is a good chance you'll be able to play and get involved. As this is the year of online, you know, the current world events do unfortunately continue, and fighting game events as we know them are, you know, still on hiatus until further notice. It is a great time to get into online tournaments. You know, if you are looking to compete, online is going to be the best way of doing it for, you know, the foreseeable until things improve. And for a game like MK11 that has the netcode as good as it is, there is no time like the present, and would love to see you in those cups in future months. However, we're going to get back to today's action, and our winners' finals will be ready to go very soon. But while we get it set up, we're going to go to a quick break. We'll see you in a few minutes. We'll be right back.
The PS4 Tournament's Open Series has been full of fantastic finishes, killer combos, and a friendship or two.
I would not trust his ability to cook anything.
We've seen promising new players and household names continue to dominate. Do not miss a single moment of the PS4 Tournament's Open Series monthly finals. This is the Mortal Kombat character breakdown, Kotal Kahn. This Oshtek warrior brings brute force to the world of competitive Mortal Kombat, where he hits hard, takes a beating, and provides different playstyles across all three variations. Before we even start with his variations though, Kotal Kahn is one of the few characters that sports more base health than everyone else. This makes you generally tankier and able to soak up more hits as you close in space, which is always your number one goal with this character. His most popular variation is Variation 1, Ascension. It brings the Kahn Cut forward, which is a full combo launcher. Amazing for using after strings and giving a combo off almost every single touch, which works wonders when you combine it with his long-ranged buttons. Ascension also boasts a command grab that majorly expands your mix-up game, which in this variation is Strike versus Throw. Totemic makes things a bit more wild, as Kotal gains access to a ground charge and an air charge. These can be amplified to be safer on block, and is useful to use after strings for this reason. He gains one totem in this variation, the Blood Totem, which allows Kotal to heal a portion of the damage that he deals while it's activated. Combine this with your base Sun Ray, and you can sustain more damage than most. Finally, Bullock expands the totem game significantly. A damage reduction totem that, as you might expect, makes you one hell of a brick wall if you activate them, and a damage totem that does exactly what it sounds like. These totems can be stacked to strengthen their effects, and Bullock in the right hands can be a source of devastating damage or to become the immovable object. Kotal is a real brawler in this game, and is a perfect fit for those that like to get up close and personal with an intimidating offensive game. The PS4 Tournament's Open Series has been full of fantastic finishes, killer combos, and a friendship or two.
I would not trust his ability to cook anything.
We've seen promising new players and household names continue to dominate.
Oh my God! Animal.
Do not miss a single moment of the PS4 tournament's Open Series monthly finals.
Welcome back, everyone, to the PS4 tournament's MK11 Open Series Invitational for the first week of December, where my name is Mustard and I'm joined by Ebonic Plague. Well, we are about to get stuck in with the winners finals of the day for North America, where we have current reigning champion Ice Scorpion, really to no huge surprise, getting to the winners finals, getting this far. But his opponent, however, is Titanium Tigers, who we know a lot in the NetherRealm community, a bit of an online demon, definitely not shying away from these online events, but today has pretty much had a great set way through Biohazard and the Mighty Unjust, who are, I would say, the two biggest household names in the Open Series. So if he can take out Ice Scorpion here, that will be quite the debut. I would argue the best debut one might be able to have in the Open Series.
Yeah, we talked about it a little bit earlier about how if you're able to make it through that sort of gauntlet, you absolutely deserve your W's, because those are three of the strongest players and most consistent players within the Open Series without question. So for MK11, if you're able to take those three out, it's you're just on another level.
I mean, they are like the Open Series. I was about to say the Open Series Elite Four, but there is a glaring error in that analysis. I'm not even going to bother. But
it's okay, I can't count, so I don't know.
they're the 1, 2, 4. Oh, you're right. Perfect. But no, a perfect way to start for Titanium Tigers. Absolutely, as we are now looking into winners finals. Now, the question is, what does Tigers bring to the table? Is this the same variation that he used to take out? It is? Okay, this is huge. So, this Kotal Kahn variation, it is not flashy, but it gets the job done. You've got safe discus, which makes everything good on block. You've got damage totem, and you've got command grab. This is a recipe for danger at the highest level for Kotal Kahn. Your damage is crazy, your chip is crazy, you keep the armor break. Nice Scorpion really trying that real reliable, the old reliable bionic bounce, grenade launcher, air shrapnel. This is a clash of styles, to be sure, by Titanium Tigers.
I feel like when you're fighting Jackie, a lot of the time you're having trouble raising damage with her because of the grenade launcher flames, right? You just cannot do as much damage as she does because of that. But with Kotal Kahn having access to just way too much extra damage in the ray of light, in the totems, all that stuff, it starts to add up pretty quick, especially when you get a command grab from full screen. You just walk up on somebody, now you can set up whatever way you want, trying to stop the leap, but no dice.
Oh, with the jumping as well, Titanium Tigers really trying to get that air to wear. Well, actually, I like the way Titanium Tigers is playing, but the whiff punish! Aye, Scorpion. No mids here, my friend. That whiff punish is ready. Now, I do like the way Tigers has been playing this, though, because if you give Kotal Kahn too much freedom, totems are coming out, sunray is going up, like, and the damage you've done is being erased. Now, Ice Scorpion is finding a really good blend of not actually quite letting him do that, but there's the sunray, back to the wall, Kotal Kahn, one of the few characters in the game that actively wants to be back to the wall,
nice.
I think. Ooh, spends the second bar on that, too.
Yeah.
Oh, but jumps himself back into the corner.
He was stuck in the flames right there, so you know, you spend the second bar and you try to get that damage made up for it. With the Ray of Light now, you're kind of negating the flames. I think flames do slightly more damage. No, it's negated completely, okay.
Yeah, it is, I would say, the most powerful healing way in the game is that sunray. Ooh! And the catch, he tried to armor break too. Tigers was very close to that. Oh, he just tried to raw grab.
Gotta watch out for that fatal blow, by the way, for Titanium Tigers. He may have a life lead, but that'll change quick!
Now, he will actually survive this by quite a considerable amount, considering he has Kotal. Now, what you can't do if you're Ice Scorpion is take this lead as a guaranteed win. Because even though you have the fire, if he gets the heal up, you're in trouble.
I do love the back roll right there. I think that was great defensive option because oh, got the throw! Epic damage, but one more mix up right here. It's the low! Oh, the low string caught him. Maybe trying to jump out, maybe expecting the mid. No way.
Oh, that was a clutch flawless block from Titanium Tigers, because not only led to an escape failed throw, but it really set up the rest of that round. Now, okay, command grab. Now, Tigers, does he take a guaranteed totem from this? Oh, wake up sleep. He actually definitely predicted it, I think.
Yeah.
But Tigers is doing a good job of knowing you're going to expect a totem, so I'm not going to do one. He's actually done like maybe two totems the entire game.
Exactly. That's what I was about to mention, is the number of totems in Rays of Light are incredibly low because he's expecting these either rush punches, you know, to get the crushing blow, or maybe the leap into Amplify.
If you're Ice Scorpion, you have to take your damage where you can find it, because you are absolutely going to struggle to go toe-to-toe with damage per hit for Kotal Kahn. And we see he's back on his Stranger Summit. There's the flawless block. Big damage incoming after this for sure. Now, Sunray or Totem or neither? What's it going to be?
Yeah, he's still looking for that rush punch or that that leap, but it's going to end up being the forward two to catch. And that's Titanium Tigers on the first game. This hypothetical run that we were talking about is now completely on the table.
No, this is really impressive. Like, to go through Biohazard, then Mighty Unjust, and now a game up on Ice Scorpion. Like, this is the boss run. This is the ultimate. You know, you're at the end of the game, you're playing all the bosses like one area at a time, and then there's the final boss. He is the final boss at the moment. The question is whether it stays that way, because that is just one game. I don't want to get too ahead of myself, because we do know Ice Scorpion. He is supremely confident on this jacket, but he does play Cetrion as well. He does play Sonya. He plays a lot of characters, and for all we know, there's more tricks up his sleeve that we haven't even seen yet that he's still holding back. However, Tigers, this variation really has been, to be honest, very impressive. Kotal Kahn is a character that has so many custom options that I feel like as a community, it's very easy for us to go crazy and think, oh, the blood totem for healing, oh, the launch and the command grab and damage for like 50% B&Bs, and oh, there's all this crazy, cool, wild stuff. And then here is just this variation that is, again, it's not very flashy. It's not the most kind of interesting on paper compared to a lot of what you can do, but it is so effective. It does decent chunks of damage at a time. The healing is good. The damage is good. The command grab, the mix-ups, the safety. It kind of does a bit of everything.
If you think about it, Kotal already had all the base options, right? He was fine with whatever like possible thing you may have wanted to do, because he had that in whatever way he wanted. And then you mix in all this extra damage, and that gives him the only thing that he was lacking, was being able to race people and damage faster.
There's the next mix up. We saw Titanium. Oh, we saw Tigers hit that. He just built the bar. Does he spend it? Okay, bar into Sunray? No. Fatal Blow will lose to it. Oh. No, he's actually jumped himself into the corner.
Okay, staying nice and vigilant right now. Doesn't want to get opened up. Nice block on the low right there, but finally the throw.
You can only block for so long. You don't mind that, though.
Yeah,
he's done that three times. But he actually has a bit of a tell. He was ducking from full screen, and every time he's gone from ducking and then into a leap, that's when he's flawless blocked. So that's kind of like a way he's telling that he's going for it. But what do you do if you're Ice Scorpion? Do you just not go in? Because if you don't go in, he gets the Sunray out, and now you're definitely not going to win. Because the Sunray will plow through Last Breath just as bad as the grenades do.
Scorpion to be able to figure out how to negate that. Right now he's doing just a good enough job being able to catch. He wanted to go for the whip punish there, but ended up getting caught by the last hit of the string.
Oh, there's the hit.
Wanted to set a fire near the totem to kind of deter thing. Yeah, he's got
the round,
but we don't want him to get a single hit, because if he gets one hit, he actually just kills. Yeah, no matter what the hit would have been there, Titanium Tigers probably would have killed with three totems.
The second you're playing against Kotal and you see the stack of three, you just have to like hold your breath. You just have to hope that you don't make a mistake. Don't get hit by a jump in, don't mess up a counter poke, don't whiff. Uh-oh, don't do that for sure. Ooh, no bar to make it safe.
I like the amplify there. That was going to be an easy whiff punish for Titanium Tigers if he did not amplify that. Oh, caught the disc throw!
Decent chunk of hard to avoid damage right there.
Oh,
the counter hit. Now all the fire's gone.
But the leap is going to whip punish on the Ray of Light. Did not matter about the Sunray there. If he was able to get the Sunray, he obviously would have been sitting nice and pretty. He would have got a lot of that health back. But I think that Ice Scorpion recognized that was the one thing that would have put Titanium Tigers back in the game. So he was like, we can't let that happen. I have to go in here. And he made the right call.
It's also the reason we're not seeing as much Sunray as you might expect. You know, as a Kotal Kahn player, you might be used to seeing Kotal Kahn be at full screen and go, why don't you just do the Ray, right? You know, get the health back. Why aren't you summoning totems? Because, I mean, it really does boil down to, if you're fighting against Jackie and she's got Hyper Leap, all it takes is one leap right as you summon either the totem or Sunray, and you've just been hit by a full jump-in combo, because that's how fast it is. And Tigers has been reserved on that for most of the set, but the one time he fell for it, that the kind of the forbidden fruit, and now it's it did unfortunately result in him losing the game. But good for Ice Scorpion, as we are tied up one game apiece now. Winners finals. Winner of this does get grand finals winner side, which does minimum second place for you. So it's at least $150. So a decent chunk of money on the line for this match.
Ooh, it looks like Titanium actually switched up the variation a little bit.
Oh, this is Bullock. He's gone back to the good old Bullock. So this is the damage reduction totem, the damage increasing totem, and the Grand Discus. So you still have the safety. You lose the command grab, but you have the ability to just wall up. And you'll see, like, the damage you don't take if you get the black totem up, it is night and day. Like, you're taking, like, half damage. Half damage to the character that has more health than everyone and heals percentage-based in the raid. It's pretty good.
I mean, hey, it's going to be pretty necessary, to be honest with you, with the way Jackie applies damage to you with that damage over time. She is just out dishing damage more than most characters with that. Okay, there's the breakaway, though. It's going to help out.
Oh, nothing there. Trying to trip guard, not happening. Discus for safety.
Yeah, really looking for those whip punishes. And I mean, that's kind of been Titanium Tiger's claim to fame in the last few sets that we've seen him play. So, oh, what the duck!
Oh my god.
That dab, easy buddy. That's such a damaging, crushing blow, and it has been the entire time.
What really sets me back about these uppercuts that Tigers is doing is they're not really done on reaction. It's, I am going to leave myself in a situation that you might want to throw or like do an instant high to counterpoke. And if you do, I'm swinging. And so if you do, you're going to get chunked by that crushing blow. Tries to punish the roll, I think.
Well, if you think about the last match in this set, actually, you notice that he was down backing for that flawless block punish, right? So he had been defending incredibly well up until the point where Ice Cold would go for that throw.
He's definitely trying to play around it, for sure. But then again, so is Ice Scorpion, as we saw him do a short leap, and he deliberately cut it short to bait Tigers into anti-airing. He got a big whip punish.
I think that's happened a couple times. Used both meter to try and stop any sort of punish there, and not a lot of health here for Titanium. He's going to have to make a... Yeah. It's just...
That was a tough situation. Now, the real unfortunate thing is he's actually changed the variation to have two totems, but he's yet to be able to summon a single one yet. This could be a situation. Good jump. Oh, but no! Loses the sun ray and the corner. Oh, but a big wake up.
Doesn't have the meter for the amplification, but that's going to put him in the corner. And yeah, I think Ice Scorpion's like, I can't let you get a totem.
Do we see a totem? Is he looking for it?
He's definitely looking for either jump or rush punch right now, so...
I mean, Tigers is swinging out these uppercut swords, like right there, from ranges there, they're practically safe near enough, I can imagine. Hard to punish at the very least. But he's doing it, I think, because he hasn't summoned totems, I think the existence of the totems is making him swing these out to try and catch him stopping him summoning them. Because there's the first one of the day, and he got punished for it. Well, first right one of the day, first one of the match at the very least.
Ooh. Oh yeah, I was looking for that whiff punish. Just gonna have to amplify to get that safety right now. The leap is gonna hit into Fatal Blow! And he had the dot on him that whole time too, so the extra damage adds up.
That's 100% gonna kill. The crazy thing is Titanium, like, just taking a step into the fire is what put him into Fatal Blow territory. So the second he got the Fatal Blow, he immediately did it. But that armor, not active until the 8th frame, so... You can get stuffed if your timing isn't quite on there. But Ice Scorpion now going up in the set. That's 2-1 now. Titanium Tigers. You know, we were talking about the potential of him winning this kind of like boss battle, but you know, the boss is the boss for the reason. And right now that's Ice Scorpion. Question is Tigers gonna be rocking out with Kotal Kahn the entire time, or do we see a change?
It's hard to say because Jackie has so many options to be able to punish a Sunray or a totem call, right? Like there's the leap, okay, so looking at the Centurion now, so yeah, I can only understand that. It's just, there's just so many ways Jackie's just blows you up for wanting to call a totem or for wanting to call the Sunray that it becomes like, you're playing the base character at that point, and that's exactly what Titanium Tigers was forced to do in that final round, was he was playing the base character. We saw one totem that whole game.
It is such a shame, and he was basically only playing around the amp discus, and even then it's meter intensive. You know, spend all your bar on discus so you never have it for the sword if you find the hit on that or whatever. Because that has always been the downfall of totem Kotal, because if you can't set up the totems, you're not playing for the main thing you have equipped, right? But as is the way, But Titanium Tiger's going back to the Cetrion. This is the variation he used to defeat Biohazard 3-0.
Episoding so strong from Titanium Tigers and has been ever since, you know, they first started playing Cetrion. Oh. But there's the dash punch crushing blow! H2 port.
Oh, that nice. Flawless block was so good. Nice, Scorpion. He is not messing around. He wants that Grand Finals. Oh, the miss. Yeah.
Throw of his own right here. Unfortunately, he is standing in the fire, so at the very least, Jackie's going to walk away with a lot more damage on that one.
Now, Tigers does have Fatal Blow. So Scorpion has to be careful. Can't extend too much.
Oh, didn't actually get the confirm, but the rest of the string still ended up connecting. He has barely any health left, but there it is, the punish. Fatal Blow.
That's absolutely going to kill Ice Scorpion. Bit off a little bit more than he could chew there. That final grenade launcher was definitely trying to stop Titanium Tigers from getting so comfortable, but wasn't enough. So Tigers just sat there, blocked it out. You don't have to worry about the ground fire. If the projectile hits you, it doesn't come out on the ground. So, you know, you don't have to worry about it there. Good teleport. Just to avoid. Oh!
A great forward roll right there. I feel like there's been so many strong forward rolls that like people just aren't ready for so far.
No, Tigers was doing that against Bio as well. Like his wake-up game has always been slippery. Absolutely just impossible to predict.
Hey, if you play a zoning character like Titanium Tigers does, that's you have to know how to be as slippery as possible for sure.
Okay. I mean, you will usually have like slower buttons or whatever it might be, maybe it's lower movement. So you have to kind of get used to playing around those. And some of that is just being really unpredictable and weird on defense. However, not enough for that round as Ice Scorpion goes into match point now, one round away from that grand finals placement. Titanium Tigers did have to use his Fatal Blow early, so that's an important resource gone now. Question is, will it make a difference here? Ooh, good pickup. Ooh, and again.
Yeah, all of these restands are just so detrimental and difficult to deal with.
And damaging. Look at the health Ice Scorpion doesn't have anymore. Good lord.
Yeah. Hey, normally it's hard to damage race Jackie, but if you get those restands over and over again, or if you catch her on the leap like that...
Ooh.
Great duck. Right there.
So that's the Fatal Blow. I mean, this is still Jackie. Jackie with Fatal Blow is quite a monster.
And there's the leap entry. Tries to use the teleport to stop it, but great amplification to hit the ground first. Yeah, gotta watch out for that dash punch right now. And catching him with the jump forward. Super good call out.
That was very preemptive from Tigers. That was definitely done just on the way up, and that was it. I always feel like that was done to catch a leap and didn't quite happen at the moment, but didn't matter. Tigers now game five. We have had a tremendous amount of game fives in this tournament for North America. Good lord. I think we're going to be in for the long haul today.
Yeah, you're always talking about consistency, and everybody who's watched the Open Series up at this point has always seen the same players over and over again, you know, like and very similar outcomes, right? But With Ultimate happening, just like you said, biggest change that this game has undertaken thus far, this could just be the time where everything shifts.
And I'm kind of expecting that. Yeah, I think right now the kind of general feel is the tier list isn't looking that different, and a lot of characters are kind of in the same scenario that they were before. But I kind of feel like that's mainly because a lot of characters, like a lot of people aren't being too experimental. I think we're already seeing characters completely transform with the addition of one move, like Kung Lao. When we first saw customs, I remember people saying that Kung Lao's customs just weren't that interesting at all. And now, a few weeks later, Buzzsaw Kung Lao is absolutely tearing up people in different events, right? Sometimes it just takes one move to change things, and I think that's where the game is going to go eventually. But for now, it's definitely the tried and expected. Cetra and Jackie, you're seeing before you. These are two of the most popular variations by far in the Open Series since customs became a thing, and for good reason. They are incredibly powerful. Oh, tries to maximize the whiff punish. That kick string does lead to a counter hit, launching crushing blows. So the damage is high, but you miss it.
So many throw escapes right here from Titanium Tigers. Pretty much guessing right on the throws every time, and then catching Ice Scorpion trying to jump afterwards with the natural barrier.
Oh, hello. Now, Ice Scorpion has been very good at that, like hit confirming that a jump in is going to hit and just going into the raw launch. No bar needed, back throw.
Okay. Oh, using the fatal, that was so smart! It does come down from the top!
I feel like that didn't connect. It looked like that barely touched.
One of them did. One of the rocks connected.
a pebble glanced the heel of Jackie's shoe. But you know what? That's fighting games, Jackie. You get used to it. Fight. Match point, Tigers, though. Yeah, man. Doesn't matter what you think happened. It's what matters that did happen.
Raiden teleported at the very start to be able to catch the grenade launcher. That lets a half a life, basically.
Ooh, Tigers is at... Oh, okay, uppercut. No momentum for you, sir.
I ain't taking it no more, son.
Leave me alone. But that single uppercut has led to almost an even life bar. Fatal blow, too. Oh, that was a very costly mistake, almost, but... Oh, that chip damage is going to add up, though. Oh, hello, instant leap. Yeah, breakaway before the dash punch KB can connect. We all know it was coming.
Definitely want that extra damage to even up the life total right now. He does have that fatal blow on deck, so I mean, Ice Scorpion can just kill from anything here. Okay, tried to catch the leap, but no dice the grenade launcher. There's that anti-air possibility that finally happens. And caught the low? No. Okay, excuse me, that was tornado.
And that's it. Tigers actually manages to secure the set with a... Yo, I haven't seen this fatality in so long. I actually forgot what it was. It's so overkill. Like, how does she go that big that fast?
Well, when you're a god, you're a god. So that's all I got.
And the beam she shot from space was wide enough that there's no way it would be that... That would be like the size of the screen. We're getting accurate. Still though, the important thing is not the physics of the fatality. It's the fact that Tigers is just doing upset after upset after upset, back to back, 3-0 over Biohazard, a win over Mighty Unjust, and a win in a Game 5 against Ice Scorpion Winners Finals. Titanium Tigers actually coming to the Open Series against all of these mainstay regular faces and just winning. That's all there is to it. He's just beating everyone.
That's all it takes. Is you just gotta win. Like there's no other option.
Damn, if only others thought of this first. If only they tried winning instead of losing. Oh, it was so simple.
Maybe if everybody else tried that, they'd be Titanium Tigers right now.
I think this is the top tier analysis that you definitely tune in for. So you're welcome, everyone. You're welcome. But no, I am. Very happy for Tigers. I imagine I just took the words right out of your mouth as he sits in winner's side at Grand Finals. But now, Ice Scorpion dropping down to that loser's final. Mighty Unjust versus Illuminati, thanks to Unjust taking it 3-0 over 2-Easy. And Illuminati defeating Biohazard another time. Biohazard definitely seeming to have some issues against Illuminati right now. Illuminati did double eliminate Biohazard not too long ago. 3-0 both times and 3-1 today. So definitely becoming a little bit of a demon with that buzzsaw for Biohazard. Now, Mighty Unjust and Illuminati. This is is this even a runback? I'm trying to remember the last time we may have seen it. I think we've seen this before, but before Customs, when Illuminati was like Lotus Fist and that was about it. But regardless, I mean, Illuminati has definitely been putting on quite the show with this buzzsaw, so I'm definitely not expecting this to be a wash for Unjust by any means.
Yeah, I mean, we used to think that Unjust was untouchable, right? So, and that has changed, and Illuminati has been bringing in, defeating Biohazard over and over again, especially with, like, the previous week with the double elimination, right? So, if anybody is looking like they have the ability to bleed right now, Unjust is probably bleeding from that buzzsaw hat here pretty soon. I'm not sure.
I mean, if you've got the towers up and you need to spill pints of blood to unlock some towers, then, you know, playing buzzsaw is not a bad way of doing it. But here's the real thing, though. I am kind of surprised that Unjust, of all players, is having a bit of a hard time with Customs. I think we're going into Custom MK11. The second NetherRealm made that announcement that Customs were going to be the norm, I instantly thought about these North American players first. You know, the ones that play every character in the game almost, that they play every variation of their existing characters like Biohazard. So I was like, if you're now giving these people that clearly think outside the box and can really broaden their horizons for who they play, surely they are the ones you would expect to really embrace Customs the most first. However, it just hasn't looked like that's happened yet in the Open Series. And I want to really specify Open Series, because there are other events, you know, community tournaments here and there that, you know, community, like, you know, organizers are doing here and there, you know, whether they're funded by you know, kind of crowdfunding or very generous viewers, or, you know, the organizers themselves putting up the money. And we are seeing these players not do terribly in those. For example, you know, Mighty Unjust did get top 8 in Aquaman's Coliseum over the weekend. So they're definitely not doing bad. But in the Open Series, their success has definitely dropped down a bit, despite the customs being there, which I would have imagined kind of catered to them a lot. However, the spawn from Mighty Unjust is going to be the second time we see this from him today.
Well, with Mighty Unjust in particular, we've seen so many different characters, so I think I agree with you in being surprised that he's having the most trouble with custom variations, because you would think that somebody who plays more characters than anybody else would be able to pick up on it faster, but I guess not.
I imagine we'll see it eventually, but there's definitely a bit of a slow burn, I think, at the very least. Now, that! Yep!
That was so smart!
There it is! There it is! Yep! Punisher, the UK boy, put that on Twitter the other day. This is some really interesting tech that Spawn could do in this matchup. So, Buzzsaw is a projectile. That cape charge, if it absorbs a projectile before hitting, will launch as a KB. So you can do exactly what you saw there. You can do button into cape charge as a punish. Hat comes out, hits the cape charge, gives you a launcher. It is sick. So sick.
76 damage out of that.
Oh, my friend. That is peanuts for Spawn, I tell you. This character absolutely decimates life bars, and I hope we get to see the higher end of it.
Gonna have to get to that point, though. Buzzsaw trying to keep him nice and safe. However, he's stuck in the corner. It's gonna be a lot of poking from Spawn for right now, rather than just, you know, being able to jump in. Buzzsaw out. Ooh, actually ended up catching.
This is that Buzzsaw neutral we're expecting. A bit more life dependent, I think. But ooh, the hit, nope. Confirm. However, the whiff punish. Ooh, no, the breakaway comes through.
Yeah, nice and safe. Just gonna back off so he can get that Buzzsaw set up probably, but I think Unjust was ready for that and just wants to walk as forward as he can.
Oh, that chip damage is gonna add up soon, though.
Yeah, I mean, hey, it's starting to get real close. The fatal blow off of one hit? That was reaction city.
That was actually amazing. I actually wonder if that was a buffer, because he did, like, almost an entire backdash first. So I wonder if he went for the backward fatal blow from a range that it would only hit if Illuminati pressed, and I think he did. Regardless, that was a very clean game number one, that Spawn pick. And this is what I love, and this is actually a token Unjust move here, where I can promise you the reason he's picked this character is, I mean, Spawn deals with Buzzsaw better than most in the game, at least at face value with what we've seen from the characters. Like, Buzzsaw Kung Lao is very kind of, it either will dominate, like Buzzsaw can either dominate, or the Kung Lao player has to be really careful about doing it based on what options you have. If Buzzsaw dominates what your character, you know, if your character basically can't stop it, it completely controls the match in every way. It'll come out on block, on hit, no matter what. It'll be an ender, it will be a neutral tool, it will be a keep away tool, it will be used to keep your arms reach, you know, it can be moved around, and it can, you know, cover jumping, and if you've got low projectile, you can make it go lower so you can't low profile it. However, if you do have an option, they have to be careful, and Spawn has that.
It's pretty similar to the Johnny Cage stunt double, actually, now that I think about it. It can actually just, like, come out, you know, if the opponent's, like, running up on Johnny, if he's called the stunt double, it'll come out even if he's blocking the string, right? So
I would definitely say it's got similarities. Like, stunt double is definitely slower, but the idea is there. Once you've done it, that move's coming out. It's as simple as that.
Yes.
And I mean, stunt doubles are definitely another move that I would like to see players experiment a bit more with. I'd love to see more stuff for it for a similar reason, but I guess we'll see eventually if that ever happens.
Yeah, we're only at the beginning of the ultimate changes, so, you know, things can change quite a bit after this. Nice block on the empty low there.
Oh, the down three interrupt.
Okay, jumps over the amplify, but not fast enough there.
Yeah, he tried to interrupt, but couldn't quite squeeze out the button.
Maybe dive kick would have done it, but, you know, that's like a hindsight thing.
Hindsight is great on commentary. You just look at someone make a mistake, it's like, oh, shouldn't have done that. Oh, the safety, spinning the bar. Oh, tried the dash up grab, but we'll pay the ultimate price as Illuminati takes the round. But no, this Spawn pick has definitely been quite an eye-opener.
No, I like it a lot. I really think it's the exact... I think that's exactly why he picked Spawn, was specifically for this matchup. You know, you were talking about the Twitter tech a moment ago, and he immediately pulled it out. It tells you that he's practiced it specifically for this matchup, or at least for something that can do something similar, right? So why not try it out in tournament? And I mean, hey, it's worked out beautifully at this point.
I mean, he's down a round, but he's up a game. So definitely not going so bad. The empty jump down three, unjust. I think he's just waiting for Buzzsaw, but Illuminati, you know, it's not his first rodeo. This is not the first time he's played someone that can deal with Buzzsaw, I promise. Oh, but there it is. Didn't come out in time. Now, the way the hat works is, though, if the hat begins, like, moving on its own, if it begins hovering, that is when it's guaranteed to stay out no matter what. If you hit him before it goes into that state, it will disappear. It's just so hard to get it into that state to begin with. But you're already seeing there, right? Like, Illuminati trying to summon that Buzzsaw, punished clean. And a clean punish with spawn is, like, 400 damage. So that's not a scenario you want to put yourself in very often if you can help it.
Especially with the particular projectile that Spawn has, that amplified projectile is going to do far more than he's going to take from the Buzzsaw. It's like, what, 77 damage from the Buzzsaw? And then he's going to do like 110 on the Amplify.
Definitely. Ooh! Found it though. That string is also unsaved, you got to be careful. But you can see how it's changed. Luminati, he can't just throw out Buzzsaw the same way he has been all day. You can't do that against his character. The dash up throw! Now, it's about crushing blows. If Unjust finds himself back to the wall, you're about to see some serious damage.
Oh, there's the breakaway already, so I mean, hey, he actually has a chance that any more hits will be unbreakable. Oh, great toss just to stop that, because that would have been...
That would have killed him, I think. Yeah, I think that would have been dead. Oh, but so will that. Unjust. Spawn pick. I mean, this is why I said this was a very Injustice maneuver. Is to pick up a character specifically for a matchup that is clearly causing problems for other people, but just for the knowledge, this isn't the first time we've seen him play Spawn in Open Series. It's not something he played a lot, but we did see him pick it here and there in early stages, earlier months. And especially as, you know, I feel like as a community, and you know, this, you're probably all too familiar with this with popular DLCs, especially in other games that have such iconic characters, where Spawn was requested by the community for like 10 years. Like, by far... Yeah. Every NetherRealm game, when's Spawn coming in? Because we've had guest characters in MK or NetherRealm games in general since 2011, right? MK9, you had Freddy Krueger, Injustice, you had the MK guest characters, you know, coming through, and every game has had them since. And since that was a proven thing, the fans have said, Spawn's got to be in MK. I don't even know what started it, but it happened. Now, 10 years later, he's in MK, and barely anyone played him competitively. He completely fell off. Like, completely and utterly just disappeared. But over the last kind of fair few months, there have been key Spawn players that have kind of crept up through tournaments and made this character look incredible. And I am here for it, because this character is sick.
I think there's only one other fighting game that Spawn's been in, other than that.
And, you would know.
Yeah, I didn't want to interrupt, but, you know, MK, when the MK people were asking for it, the Soul Calibur players got it, actually. So.
Funny. How life works sometimes. Soul Calibur 2. Not Mortal Kombat 11, but you know, about 15 years too early.
Hey, you know, you guys got it though. It only took 15 years. That's all it is.
Hey, you know what? And I'd say he's worth the wait. Right now for Unjust to be 2-0 up. I think he'd agree.
Yeah, and definitely looking strong on that 2-0 even in the next round. Okay, gonna be able to catch him right there. Full damage on this.
Plus frames. Oh, trying to jump out. You can see Illuminati being visibly uncomfortable here. Really trying to squeeze his way out of these plus frames, but just isn't working as Unjust goes to a match point. Completely seeing how the matchup has changed. When Buzzsaw does not work every single time, I mean, just look at the whiff punish. When Buzzsaw is taken out and you're just left with the ability to press buttons and do your damage. Oh my goodness. Oh, what a combo.
Yeah, It's similar to that Titanium Tiger's Kotal, where it just feels like he's playing the base character now because Buzzsaw is no longer as strong.
I mean, he's got a guided hat, but we're definitely not seeing that. Oh, no, orbiting hat. Oh, it's... Oh, hang on a minute. Wait, no.
He must have switched on this game.
Yeah, no, of course. I don't know how it took me... I think I was too busy talking about Spawn, but he's actually completely changed variation. He's gone to Z hat and orbiting hat. This is completely different. And that, by itself, is evidence enough that the Spawn pick has worked, because it's taken away the Buzzsaw completely, and that is a one decision if you're Unjust for now.
It's still looking hard even despite the variation. Ooh. Pick right there. He's got the hit gonna go directly into that fatal blow.
Now that's definitely gonna kill. This fatal blow either doesn't scale or scales too much. There's like no in between, and this will definitely be the former. That's 400 damage off a jump in confirmed. and Illuminati, the variation change making a big difference here. If you pick a variation, and this is again where customs help out. You pick a variation for something and that move doesn't work, I mean, just have another variation that does. Enter customs.
Hey, that's one of the reasons why I think everybody was so excited for the idea of customs being legal at everything, regardless of what it was.
It's character specialists being able to explore, you know, like being able to be a true specialist. If there are moves that help you in certain matchups, and instead of changing complete variations and the whole playstyle is different, just swap a move here or there, or in this case, a complete overhaul, as long as you're still playing the character you like, then same difference. Ooh.
So does the cape not actually grab that projectile because it moves more?
I actually haven't seen that interaction, but I imagine if there's the hat hitting multiple times, I don't think it's the cape only absorbs one projectile. I think it only absorbs one hit of the projectile. And as Z-Hat hits three times as it changes angle, it will count, but Illuminati. Now, I can promise you we're probably going to see unjust change, because this was not picked to deal with Lau. This was picked to deal with Buzzsaw specifically. And now, because he's up two games, or one game now, but still, now that the reason he's picked the character is complete, he doesn't have to worry about Buzzsaw now. He can just play against his normal anti-Lau. We might even see him go to Shang Tsung, because Shang Tsung is the go-to counter for Orbiting Hat style Kung Lao. And Shang Tsung is not a bad character for Injust. He has played it before.
Hey, it's definitely one of the stronger zoning picks for sure, dealing with that body drop, the fireballs. The character keeps you right out at all times.
That is the whole point. Shang Tsung does not play for your viewing pleasure.
It's very thematic of the character for sure, without question. But So
I am actually quite surprised to see this, because it's a very unjust style to go, right, this is what you're stuck with, so I'm going to counterpick it. But I can only imagine he's playing a lot more spawn, because thing is, just because that variation has changed does not mean that the spawn won't work anymore, because he still won that first round dominantly, and you know, it was still a close game. But here we go again, the charging hell spawn, the glide, this tried and true variation that many spawn players are still sticking with for that big damage. It does give you the highest damage BMBs really in the game. Oh, but another big jump in, Illuminati.
Yeah, definitely seeming a lot more comfortable on the aggression for Illuminati. Before it was like, I feel like Buzzsaw made Illuminati want to be less aggressive until Buzzsaw was out. But now that he doesn't have Buzzsaw, he's just being aggressive without it regardless.
Well, Kung Lao with and without Buzzsaw is a very different character. Without Buzzsaw, he's much more about kind of just constant point blank and the threat of counterpoke, you know, canceling everything into that right there, the orbiting hat. It's meter intensive, like it takes a bar of both offense and defense, but it comes back very quickly. So you actually find that you're not spending as much as you would think. Oh, but the wake up buttons, no confirm, however. Still unjust forward throw.
He's gotta watch out for these wake up options, because he does not have a lot of health left.
Oh, that dash up grab again, he's being brave. Now, Illuminati also put into fatal blow territory. Delay wake up. Oh, whiff! Big punish, and the bar spent. Gets himself cornered, but honestly, doesn't really matter. Like, the important thing is winning the round. Unjust match point once again. Both of the crouch block.
Yeah, well, I mean, there's a lot you could do point blank range at round start, and you definitely don't want to take the wrong option.
Oh, hello.
Tackle.
Oh, there's the hit and the confirm, both bars for them. No, just paying the one. Plus frames. The respect again, Illuminati does not want to get opened up here. Cannot let that happen, but it's gonna happen. Oh no.
So much damage just from one whiff punish right there, and he's got complete corner control on this. Yeah, Illuminati just had no idea on how to be able to do it. Just crouch blocking, eventually stood up into it, and that's gonna do it.
There's the spawn friendship, why not? It's not an unjust set if it doesn't end in a friendship, for sure. There's no two ways about it. Now, the spawn pick did work out all the way to the end, as, to be honest, not the character I thought would see the most from Unjust today, but forever the surprise is the mighty Unjust, as he goes through to losers finals guaranteed. And that does mean that our top three is going to be Titanium Tigers win a side ground finals, Ice Scorpion and the Mighty Unjust about to play in the losers finals, and that's our top three. A really fitting top three today. Now, if you had said to me before today started that this was going to be our top three, I would have believed you, but not in this order. the fact that it's unjust and Ice Scorpion having to, I mean, them running it back is like, I mean, you expect to see this every week. This is nothing new. But seeing it in the losers finals, that is where it's very unexpected.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that. It completely changes the tide of anything most people are used to. Because, like, look at this bracket, especially the scores in particular. Biohazard lost to Titanium Tigers 3-0, Mighty Unjust 3-1, and then Ice Scorpion. It only got a little bit more difficult each time for Titanium Tigers, but was still able to come out on top through the best of the best that the Open Series has to offer. No one... I don't think anybody's fantasy brackets, if they had one for this, is intact right now.
No, I, which is weird, because again, you know, I feel like we start a lot of shows by talking about how we have the same players, and to be completely honest, a lot of the results do end up being quite similar, because as you see players over the months, like, everyone improves, but there is always going to be a clear divide between the winning players and the players that make it every week, and I don't mean for that to sound disrespectful at all. It's that you can tell the difference between someone that is, like, consistent tournament winning, like, top level, and players that are still currently on their grind. They're still seeing those improvements, and you're seeing it gradually, and you see their placements gradually get better and better through the weeks. But then you have, like, the Ice Scorpions and the Mighty Unjust, which you know are, okay, favorite tool. They're going to be in grand finals in some way. Technically not wrong today, just in a different kind of way. But I love that change. I love that difference between the fact that this is not only Titanium Tiger's debut into the Open Series Invitational, but in such a dominating fashion, with such an interesting selection of characters to make it work, no less. But yeah, we'll talk more about Tigers very soon. But before we do, we have a losers finals to understand. To get underway. What am I talking about? My brain is mush. Mighty Unjust, Ice Scorpion, they have played against each other countless times over the months. And I mean months, all the way back to the start of Open Series back in, I think it was June we started for Mortal Kombat. Mighty Unjust and Ice Scorpion was like first couple of weeks we were having as our grand finals. Like, this was a weekly thing for a very, very long time, where they would play early on. Unjust would basically win most of the time, but Ice Scorpion was also the first person to ever defeat the Mighty Unjust in the Open Series by denying him his second monthly final championship. He was able to beat him there. But then again, for months after, it kind of went back to Unjust being able to win most of the time. Now, fast forward the clocks many months later, I mean, you can literally see right here, right? 4 monthly wins for Unjust, 18 invitationals, and Ice Scorpion second place with 2 monthlies and 3 invitationals. That's still incredibly dominant and really, you know, impressive, but it doesn't hold a candle to the sheer quantity of the Mighty Unjust. Now, that was the case for months and months and months and months and months. Now, MK11 Ultimate, Customs, Ice Scorpion, and the Mighty Unjust, they have faced off in every tournament since we started doing Customs in the Open Series, and every time, Ice Scorpion has been able to take it. It is always Game 5, it is always nail-bitingly close, but Ice Scorpion is consistently now, over the last couple of weeks, the one to take it and walk away the champion. So my real question is this where we see Unjust resume how things used to be, or has Ice Scorpion truly started a new chapter in the Open Series between them?
No matter what, they'll have to go through, one of them will have to go through Titanium Tigers, and so a new chapter is still prominent, even if the normal things happen with the Ice Scorpion being able to take things over in the Ultimate version of this game. We are going to see the spawn staying here for Unjust. It's always a toss-up for me what I think he's going to play. And I'm always wrong.
Honestly, I think I've commentated 30 of his tournaments in the Open Series, and I still have no idea. Like, it's just one of those things that you just accept. Now, the big thing, though, is I talk about how they've played so much recently, and Unjust has consistently lost the sets, and Ice Scorpion's been able to clutch it out. Ice Scorpion is always playing either this or Cetrion. This Jackie variation, more specifically, or Cetrion. Unjust plays a different character every time. I think he's still in the process of trying to find his answer for the way Ice Scorpion is playing now. He hasn't consistently been able to find it yet.
Oh yeah, that dash punch is going to be super good for the whiff punish on those normals. Anytime you see that come out.
What's that interesting really is though the is spawn play.
What's interesting though is you're not going to see a ton of grenade launcher because spawn can actually whiff punish that. depending on when it's done, right? So you're not going to see it in the normal ranges that we saw it in the previous sets, I feel like.
I don't think it's going to be used as flippantly. I think you're definitely going to have to respect the risk that is now attached to it, because you've got the cape charge, the standing three, like that long range chain attack is, you know, what most characters have as, like, it'll be a standing kick, but for Spawn it's that. You have to worry about it. It is something that must be respected. Still though. Yeah, well,
Spawn can't kick. He's got that bucket on his leg. It's too heavy.
Does not have the strength to lift it. There it is. Spawn, he does have a lot of plus frame situations, and those plus frames can be enforced with big damage, speaking of which, ask and you shall receive.
Yeah, and this is off of a low string, like a low starter.
Ooh, whip punish! Just got the bar back, that should be the round.
Absolutely. Ooh. And he wasn't even guns. Done.
He has machine guns as well, by the way. He doesn't use them, but, you know, he's
packing. No, he uses them in the Fatal Blow.
You know, that's true, but he also
all the guns.
He uses like 100 guns.
I guess that's true.
Now, a good start for Ice Scorpion. But might unjust him. The life deficit is one touch from Spawn.
Ooh. Just gotta keep him sitting in that fire as long as possible. I do like the idea for Ice Scorpion to leap back over to it.
Oh, that is not good for unjust.
That's gonna hurt.
Optimal! 400 damage. Disgusting.
Well, I mean, luckily for unjust, you got the flawless block there, so he negated some of the chip at least.
Oh, punish!
Oh, but the fire still there. The tackle didn't go far enough to get him out of it.
Now, friendship. if he had like 2% more health, we may have seen a different story, but not meant to be. I want to point out as well, though, an interesting thing about Unjust is, Unjust is playing the variation that has. So he's gone out of his way to equip the charging Hellspawn, which is the launching special move where, you know, dives forward, amplify it, launches big damage. But he's also got the Air Glide, which is a special that he's using in corner combos for, like, you know, standard, you know, B&Bs. But the real benefit of the Glide is it gives you massive damage on every touch. So mid-screen B&Bs, damage goes up. Corner B&Bs, damage goes up. But he's not using it outside of very specific corner combos. When he's getting most of his damage in the mid-screen, whether it's like off anti-airs, air-to-airs, whatever it may be, or even just standing buttons turned into the charge, I feel like for the slot he's allocated to the Glide, there's so much more he could be doing with it for Spawn. And Spawn has a lot of custom options, but I feel like a lot of Spawn players are kind of stuck to what they already used and aren't really looking too much about what else you can put in that one slot.
Yeah, it hasn't exactly gotten a ton of mileage. We've only really ever seen it in the combos, and only ever seen it in the corner combos. I don't know if we've actually seen it mid-screen too often.
No, I'm looking for it, but I'm not seeing it.
So I guess I could see what you mean by possibly, you know, oh god, got the punish on the rush punch. A round start.
Good start.
It gives you a ton of damage, but if the opponent blocks it.
I'm so happy it's a thing I can say now. Because when that dash punch was safe, I could never understand it. Now we may rejoice. Oh, whiff punish! Spend two bars or just one? And there it is again, like right there. That did 337. That's a respectable amount of damage. But off that same B&B, you can get close to 400 if you just do the jump two, cancel, jump two. Like that right there. There's the flight. We didn't see it mid-screen. We saw it in the corner. So Unjust is only using it for that corner B&B. Which, you know, it got the job done. So it's, you know, it definitely is enough. But I feel like it's worth doing the mid-screen. Then again, we do see a lot of Spawn players go for the mid-screen at the optimals, and they do drop them and end up punishable on hit. So I guess there is that risk you have to worry about.
It could be that he's not confident in that particular combo and just kind of, you know, trying to make sure he gets the guaranteed damage, because it's still a lot. Don't get me wrong. I mean, like, look at that health.
Cool. 394. That was with the flow too. Yeah, you can basically get that damage mid-screen as well, but it's a lot trickier, to be sure. Now, this game has been, oh my goodness. That was dominant.
How fast was that?
I feel like we maybe mentioned one point and then the game was over. So
right,
pretty
well,
quick.
I mean, you know, regardless of whether or not the flip got used outside of corner combos, it was still the Mighty Unjust that entire game, and it was emphatic.
Well, that's the important thing, though, right? Because it's not like if he had something that wasn't the Glide, he would have won the first match or anything. It's just you look at what you've equipped and the kind of use you're getting out of it, and you can't help but think, is there something a bit more efficient that I could equip here? But even if it's like, you know, not being used every time, if it's used enough to get the job done, then there's still an argument to be made for that. Now, okay, we saw this from Ice Scorpion last Oh, I can't remember if it was the monthly final or if it was the invitational, because they literally play in every event, so they kind of blur into one for me by now. But the Snoop Cybot from iScorpion. It's definitely not, not the flashiest character in the game, but this variation right here, the air slam, shadow portals, just makes his teleport launch, which is huge damage, and shadow slide is Noob Cybot's best move. So it's a good projectile, good safety, good footsies, whiff punishment and whatnot, good KB, and I think spawn. Oh, wow, GameStop flawless block. That is a statement.
I guess he had run into that situation so many times versus Unjust in the past few matches. I guess he was just looking for it and he really wanted to make it happen. That's why he saw the breakaway immediately. Mighty Unjust knew what was coming due to that.
He's playing in 2 steps ahead, like 4D.
4D chess.
Oh. Yeah.
Well, I mean, Unjust also plays this character, so I wonder how much of it's actually going to mix him up.
Oh, big damage. 300 damage teleport. Why not?
That's... wow. I mean, he did have to spend the bar on it.
Okay. Oh, wow, the breakaway. Right, he's there. That's it. I only hope was to flawless block that, and even then, I don't know if it would have saved him. Ice Scorpion. Oh, that started off that big teleport, too.
Okay, jumping over the slide, but no full conversion off it. Just a little bit too far away. Slide is going to be the name of the game for a little bit.
Oh, yeah, big hit there. Actually, could have confirmed it, but did not. Escape failed, I see. Really trying to play for that corner throw game. No slide. Ice Scorpion really being quite greedy with this bar. There it is.
Yeah, the bar has been mostly used for Ice Scorpion in combos with Noob so far. Not really just like the... okay. Get a bro to get back in there.
We did see how much damage Ice Scorpion was able to secure thanks to that. Oh, speaking of launching teleport, there's the pickup. Chunky.
Yeah, last time he actually he only got the standing one, but that time I think he was a little bit more ready for it. So
now this health, fatal blow will kill Ice Scorpion. Did the dash up, grab, connect. It's okay.
Punching bag got enough to kill, but yeah, Shadow Slide and Shadow Tackle are just so scary right now. There it is.
Ooh, speaking of which, he just cancelled as well. He did the cape charge to absorb a projectile, but cancelled it before the projectile hit him. That was a shame for Unjust, but Ice Scorpion getting that game on the board with Noob Cybot going up in the set once more.
I wonder if Shadow Slide would have been caught by the cape charge into cancel rather than... Because the tackle's a little bit slower, you know? The Shadow kind of runs, whereas, like, the slide is almost instant.
So I'm pretty sure it does, but I know that... So MK11 has some moves that are anti-projectile, but they actually lose to certain projectiles. And I know that sounds crazy, but there are some ranged special moves that they just don't count as projectiles. So, for example, Shang Tsung's Corpse Drop is, by all intents and purposes, a projectile, but...
I don't know what you mean. That's a physical body. It has to be a physical hair,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, exactly. But despite definitely being a projectile, it will go through projectile immune moves. So, for example, Jade's Glow, you know, when she goes purple and she just starts glowing, that makes her immune to projectiles. So even buttons and attacks that are projectiles, for example, Fujin, he's got a back too where he just creates like a wall of wind. That counts as a projectile, so that will get immune by that. But like Shang's Corpse Drop doesn't. So I don't know if like Noob's Slide counts as something like that, or if it's the same kind of thing before. However,
get the training mode for and check, because we wouldn't know, because he did cancel that cape.
So. Yeah, we didn't find out there. I know the tackle. I'm pretty sure he actually went for the tackle, not the slide there. So
it was the tackle.
Yeah, so the tackle I'm pretty sure would have been absorbed, but the slide I'm not certain on. It's not an interaction I've seen myself in a long time. The radius. I'd have to like refresh my memory, but I know there are definitely strange interactions like that. Oh, big idea, but punishable on hit. This is damage.
Yeah, we saw this damage a little bit earlier, and I think that's why he went towards that breakaway.
Indeed. Save yourself from the lion's share of it.
Blast block on the slide.
By Scorpion, he is up 2-1, so if he can win this match, this will officially be another set he's been able to take off Unjust, and he will get that run back in Grand Finals.
Okay, restand. But he challenges instead.
Yeah, that restand is like, I think it's like +4. So dashing down one does pretty much guarantee a hit, but Unjust got a little bit too eager and Ice Scorpion called it out. It's one of those restands where it's like, you're guaranteed something low reward, So I know you're going to do something a bit greedier, so I'm going to do something that will stop the greed. Some big mind games going on.
Worked out perfectly for Ice Scorpion. He's going to amplify that to keep himself in the position to keep pressing buttons as well. Super good use of meter right there. Okay, punish. Restand again, here it is. Okay, so yeah, that time I think he recognized that Ice Scorpion was willing to press buttons, and he was like, you know what, let's just take the guaranteed.
Oh, yeah, just taking the damage there. Boss frames again, ooh. That one just really enforcing that down one. That down one hit does jail into good offense. You want to keep that turn going. Final round. Fight. All right, Scorpion, this is match point. This is for elimination. And just desperately needs to win this round. Reaction!
Yeah, that's one of the best parts about having a teleport for Noob Saibot is just the fact that you can get so much damage off that too if you have the bar, not just the fact that you punished
it. Man. It really does. It does so much.
It's not just the fact that you punish the projectile. It's that you punish the projectile with a statement.
And it's like, it's such a fast move as well, right? It's almost like the way Scorpion players would teleport projectiles. It's very similar. It's just upwards, not to the side. Ooh. Oh, rolls through and still punished! That's still punished? Good lord.
Yeah, forced the breakaway because that would have been a ton of damage. Just the forward throw here.
Donk. Oh, there's another one. That wasn't a whiff punish, right? Scorpion just got caught. Both bars, uppercut, boom! 460 damage of a standing button. Ouch.
Final game, we go. We talked about how these two meet each other all the time anyway, and how there's kind of a rivalry right now for these two, pretty much. You know, normally we would see this probably in grand finals instead, but looking like it's not the case here, obviously, and we got to figure out who keeps their legacy going. Is it Ice Scorpion here with the ultimate, you know, being strong because of the variations and stuff like that he's been so good at? Or does Mighty Unjust make that comeback from, I mean, you guys saw the scores earlier in how these two players have fared in the Open Series so far. Mighty Unjust has been the staple just forever, honestly.
Well, it's like we said before the set started, you know, this has been an eternal back and forth. Since the start of Open Series, right at the beginning, Unjust and Ice Scorpion had a little bit of a, you know, Unjust would win a lot, and then Ice Scorpion began to win. But then there was months, and I mean months and months, of when Ice Scorpion just couldn't touch Unjust anymore. He just could not find an answer. But, and then it kind of stopped being a rivalry at that point, because it kind of went from a rivalry to Unjust is the clear favorite every time. And now, I mean, it has flipped. It has completely flipped since Customs have begun. And Ice Scorpion was considering the Cetrion, but decided to stick it out with Jackie. And this is an important game 5 for both these players, I promise you. Unjust is going to want to be eager to prove that he is not just going to lose to Ice Scorpion every time. And Ice Scorpion is going to kind of keep that legacy going as, I will beat you now. Like, this is my game now. And it always goes to game 5, so we always find ourselves in a situation. We never know.
Great ant here right there and a good damage. Yeah, spends that bar for the extra. Low gets blocked. Yeah, gotta keep it safe with the amplifier.
This is not a time to get greedy with that bar.
Absolutely not. Game 5, you're staring down super powered Jackie in the face. Like...
And again, really trying to keep at arm's length. Oh, dashing under doesn't quite get the range. Plus frames. Yeah, the respect. Ice Scorpion. He knows.
It's so nice for Jackie, too, because even if she gets that restand and the resulting mix-up does not, like, confirm into anything good, she still has the extra damage on you
from
the dot, but oh my goodness!
That was gorgeous. That was a really late ant, yeah, and then a full whiff punish back-to-back without hesitation. Unjust really seized that round back from a very uncertain situation. Now it's match point. Oh, another hit, but no bar, so it doesn't matter as much yet. The dash-up grab again. Oh no.
Be able to stop the leap right there, but okay, stop the leap on that one.
Oh,
got the jump.
Yeah, it doesn't get the restand. Now that grenade not going to do as much. This is quite the life deficit. Even the grenade won't catch this up. But no bar either for Unjust. He's spending so much of it on the safety. He's not got it for the damage. Big hit there. Decent chunk of damage into the corner, but the dash out.
Yeah, sometimes you got to disrespect. You got to just be able to just go on ahead. Like that decision from Unjust, and yeah, I love that normal specifically. I think that's the, you said it was the 4-3.
Oh, the chain is standing.
The chain
is
standing. Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I was not expecting that to kill right there and then. An unjust, no, the disrespect.
Oh. Friendship now? No?
Yeah, of course. Okay, that's the friendship. The disrespect into friendship over the acid ball. Why not? Unjust being able to finally undo what has been happening to him tournament after tournament after tournament. Ice Scorpion has become a bit of a demon for him in the Open Series until today, where the Game 5 this time goes to Unjust. So I think, if anything, we absolutely have the return of the rivalry. You know, this was a rivalry at the start of Open Series. It stopped being one for a while due to Unjust's dominance. And now I'd say it's gone back to being one again, as Ice Scorpion has won the last, I think, three tournaments before today they played in. And now today, it's already gone back the other way. So, and it was Game 5. It's always Game 5. So as far as I'm concerned, this has completely gone into to rivalry territory once again. And as a fan of the Open Series, I'm happy to see that.
Hey, it's nice when things change up every now and then, you know, for sure. One thing I was trying to mention, though, was I really do think that standing three from Spawn was a big game changer, specifically because of the fire pools, right? So normally you would set that amplified leap into the fire pool, and normally somebody would have to walk up into the fire pool to pressure Jackie. Spawn could just do that from outside of the fire pool and then just get as much damage as possible regardless.
It really is a magic button, you know, being able to attack her out of a longer range so you don't really have to hurt yourself at the same time. It's an amazing anti-air. It doesn't have, I mean, it can't be whiff punished, right? Because it isn't Spawn. It's like, it's not actually him that does it. You can't whiff punish it. It has no hurtbox, so it's literally just you will not die to it because you can't whiff punish it, right? It's one of those buttons. But to trade off for that has a tremendous amount of whiff recovery. But if you space it right and you use it at the right time, and especially if you use it as an anti-air, don't really have to worry about that. But that does mean that our grand finals is locked and ready to go. At least it will be when we have the lobby ready. But Titanium Tigers and the Mighty Unjust. Titanium Tigers is there on the winner's side in this double elimination tournament. That means basically he is in the winner's side. Everyone starts in winners. If you lose, get knocked into losers. Grand finals is made up of someone from winners, someone from losers. And I'm explaining this just because it is the PlayStation Twitch and there's a chance that maybe we've got some new viewers. So as Unjust is in losers, he has to win the grand finals, the 3 out of 5 set, to reset the bracket and then win again. Titanium Tigers only has to win 1 3 out of 5 because he's in the winner's bracket, hasn't lost yet. He's got half the work to do. You can mull that over and think about what I just said while we go into this break, as we have our grand finals almost ready to go. But for the final time today, we're going to go to a break for a few minutes. We'll come back very soon with grand finals. You do not want to miss it. Will Titanium Tigers be able to win his debut tournament, or will Unjust be able to reclaim that former glory? We'll find out in a few minutes' time. We'll see you then.
The PS4 Tournament's Open Series has been full of fantastic finishes, killer combos, and a friendship or two.
I would not trust his ability to cook anything.
We've seen promising new players and household names continue to dominate.
Oh my god! Animal. Oh dear!
Do not miss a single moment of the PS4 Tournament's Open Series monthly finals. PlayStation. This is the Mortal Kombat character breakdown for Cabal. MK's fastest combatant and a reliable pick for any player looking to win games with strong neutral and footsies. Cabal is very well equipped fundamentally. He has buttons for days, with mids good for any range you find yourself at and is built around them. Cabal excels between jump and sweep distance, with a strong diagonal air projectile that works in tandem with his grounded buttons. Not only that, but he has one of the strongest armor breakers in the game in Hook Slam and Nomad Dash for a meterless stun. The variations are about which of these tools excel more and how much they add to his fundamental game plan. Mean Streak is a variation that will be familiar to fans of Mortal Kombat 9, as it allows him to spend defensive bar to cancel his Nomad Dash, allowing for dangerous frame traps and hit confirms for those with the execution to handle them. This also turns the diagonal air saw into a horizontal saw, allowing for easier air confirm, and grounded saw for a strong low projectile. Clean Cut adds the low hook, which can be dangerous when used at a point where Cabal would normally do an overhead, such as his back 1-2, forward 2-2-4, or forward 4 1 plus 3. This move is unsafe, however, and as Cabal is normally a very safe character, this can be quite the style change. Clean Cut also gets Extended Hook for a restand that you can use anywhere, eliminating your opponent's wake-up options entirely. The Spins is the most popular variation, and for good reason. Spinning and Air Hook are combo pop-up tools that add a chunk of damage to any standard Cabal combo, which helps his conversions and overall combo damage. Gas Cloud is also a restand that works best in the corner, but can also be amplified to make anything safe on block with pushback, or amplified in neutral to create a cloud that heals you, amongst other benefits. Cabal is an absolute monster on the ground. When played at the right range, he can delete opponents with whiff punishes and superior footsies. He has a strong button for any situation and numerous crushing blows that can help him in a pinch, along with one of the scariest fatal blows in the game due to its constant presence. In the hands of a player with strong fundamentals, Cabal can be a serious force to be reckoned with.
All right, and we are back here with the MK11 Open Series on PS4. We have finally rounded out to Grand Finals. I'm Ebonic Plague, and I am joined here by Legendary Mustard. I'm happy to be here, despite the fact that I'm not, usually the MK11 guy. I'm sorry your brother's not here, but...
No, honestly, it's been great. It's been great chatting with you today, you know? And for those of you watching that might be a little bit confused as to why doesn't the other guy that looked like me here instead, life has a funny way of sometimes throwing a bit of a curveball at you. And at very last minute, he became unavailable, and Ebonic Plague is an absolute champ and was available and ready to kind of step in and help out. So I do thank you very much for that. This has been a really fun evening, and I hope you've had a good time so far.
Oh, I've been having a great time, specifically because of the quality of these matches. Like, you guys check out the comparison right here. Titanium Tigers, new to the Open Series, how we've been talking about. The Mighty Unjust, normally who we see winning a lot of things. But Titanium Tigers on the winner's side of this. And this is one of the reasons why I feel like the match quality has been so high. It's just that there's been a monkey wrench thrown into what normally goes on in this bracket. And so what has happened is they've all been trying to up their game just to stop Titanium Tigers. We saw the Mighty and just stop Ice Scorpion there in the losers finals just to make it back to this point.
He is the invader of the Open Series today, is Titanium Tigers. You know, he took out Biohazard right at the start. He took out Mighty Unjust just after. And he took out Ice Scorpion in the winner's finals. And they are, as far as I'm concerned, the three most kind of recognizable players across the Open Series, right? Out of all of our regular players, they are the three names you think of first with North America. And Titanium Tigers has been able to take out all three of them so far. Now, he is winner side grand finals, so he only has to win 1-3 out of 5. Unjust has to reset their brackets, so he's got a lot of work to do. However, this is what we see all too often, where we see a continuation of a set seen previous. So Titanium Tigers and Unjust, they were swapping a bunch of characters before. We saw the Kotal Kahn from Tigers, and then we've seen Cetrom, we've seen Kotal Kahn, we've now seen the Geras. The Geras is what he used to seal the deal against Unjust when Unjust went to Spawn. Because of this move, the Shifting Sands, it is a big pain for characters like Spawn that kind of sit stationary while they're pressing buttons, because it kind of moves them away, makes things that are safe unsafe, as we will no doubt see at some point.
Well, you specifically talked about one move that is normally safe as long as the opponent blocks it, but has an incredible amount of whiff recovery, and that's that standing three from Spawn. And if we can see that Shifting Sands make standing three go out of range, there could be some bad times ahead for the Mighty Unjust.
Let's hope for his sake we don't see it, but for our morbid curiosity that we do. Oh, there's the low. Well, the biggest problem, though, is when you try and punish with Shifting Sands behind you, you will so automatically default. Oh, the damage.
Oh, 460. Good lord.
This, you weren't welcome joking. To Spawn. You were telling me the yep. truth. This is Spawn damage. That is just mid-screen, get a hit, double amp the charge, uppercut ender, boom. Almost half life there and then. But the big change we're seeing, though, is Tigers, he's trying to establish the Shifting Sands, but it just isn't doing anything at the moment. Unjust is playing out around them so much better. I feel like he definitely got caught off guard by them before. Like, there, right? Just a full forward dash.
Yeah, Shifting Sands, dash it does... on wake up as well. It's not even just like forward dash and neutral after shifting sands. He'll do shifting sands after knockdown and he'll dash on wake up immediately. He's like, I'm not having this.
Exactly, because shifting sands, it sucks you back in if you jump or if you do a string, like there, right? You do anything that isn't walking or standing still and it'll pull you in. So forward dashing is unaffected by it, but forward dashing can be checked by buttons from tigers or, you know, sand trap on the buffer there on the forward three, all that mid. So juicy. And the roll again, forward roll, does not want to be near the sands at all.
Yeah, I definitely think that's the name of the game, though, is just negate shifting sands as much as possible like that into the fatal blow.
Now, that has already been the biggest change we're seeing from Unjust, is he reads that Tigers is going to do shifting sands, and he just bolts it forward. He's like, you're going to do it, so I'm just going to move in right now. And if he sees it, boom, it's a free hit. And with Spawn, that's 400 life. Very dangerous indeed.
It's such game a one. Good call out and such a good game plan. It's because Shifting Sand was the crux of what was destroying the Mighty Unjust before. It was the crux of the of Titanium's Tiger's game plan versus Mighty Unjust in that previous set. So when you negate that, Titanium Tigers now has to doubly think about what he's doing. Maybe Shifting Sands isn't so strong that it's all that needs to be done just to defeat Unjust. You know, now you have to figure out what else needs to be added to that.
I think it definitely threw off Unjust in the first time they played. Like, that much is absolutely certain. The real question is, do we see... Because there's definitely a chance we'll see the same variation again, because it's not like I've lost one match and now the move doesn't work. It's, do you play around it? Do you use it in a different way, maybe? Do you... Because I think the biggest thing that was holding him back was he was using a lot of shifting sands just in the neutral. At times that it actually will lose on just running at him and getting a hit. Because with Spawn, you only need to get in range for forward two or standing three, you know, the chain or the advancing cape moves, whatever it is, that's only where you've got to be. And Spawn, his forward dash is super good, so he's not going to take too long to get there. And there it is. Yeah, you block one sand trap, and then that's it, you dash out, simple.
Yeah, I think Sand Trap, however, the change in using it more often than the Shifting Sands themselves is probably going to be the name of the game for Titanium Tigers to change things up, because, you know, you'll want to be looking for Shifting Sands in neutral like you were talking about, but if you're not looking for the Sand Trap instead, you might actually get caught by it.
Definitely a possibility. Tries to jump out. Ooh, the commitment. Okay.
Yeah, breakaway immediately. Doesn't want to deal with that extra damage. Doesn't want to give him the chance to put Shifting Sands back on top of him either.
Oh, and even down... Good. Yeah, even down to the end there, Unjust. He got a hit into the charge, knew that Tigers was going to break away in expectation of the amp, so he didn't amp. Oh, we've punished the uppercut with an uppercut. That's the MK11 special right there.
And that's huge damage because he's going to be able to time freeze. Yeah, double uppercut and puts him right back into the corner. He unfortunately dropped the ender, though.
He did 500 damage and lost 300. Good block.
Well, he did 500 damage, and that wasn't even the ender.
I know. That's like big MK9 vibes. I was a Cyrex player in a game where his BNBs did like 70%, so I'd drop it at 50 and be like, oh, damn it. So much damage left on the table.
I can't believe it.
His life. No, the buffer again.
Yeah, just immediately uppercut, finish it off. Easy money. That buffer has been paying off dividends off of that knee. Fight.
Safety. Oh, hello. There's that sand trap. Such a strong move. 145 damage just by itself.
Oh. Yeah, and I mean, that's one of the reasons why I think it would be so pivotal to catching him thinking that, like, he needs to get away from shifting sands, because if you forward dash and you get caught by that, you take that amount of damage and then he gets Oki afterwards.
There's the change. Tigers, he knows that's a high. Doesn't jail up every button. Confirm. And there it is again, the breakaway. Oh, hello. Dashing in and out, really trying to bait a button to whiff punish.
Oh, confirm. Well, I mean, maybe not a confirm, but...
Definitely looking for it. Oh, no, he actually might be dead. No, he'll be alive, but this is really good meter management. So Unjust spending a bar of his two on the launch and then the fatal blow. This has a ton of damage, and you're left with one bar to threaten a fireball to finish off for safety. There it is.
Right there to negate as much chip as possible. Walks into it and then gets caught afterwards.
Yeah, Tigers definitely was trying so hard to not extend that he kind of just got clipped, I think. He was trying so hard to avoid a big opening that he was just getting kind of just really pelted with little bits of damage here and there, right? You know, down one here or a little bit of fireball chip there. And at that life, that's all it really takes to make a big difference. Unfortunately, Tiger's kind of let that one... I don't want to say he let it slip through, because at the end of the day, that was just a really good comeback and really good meter management from Unjust. But you have to be careful. When Spawn has meter and he's got Fatal Blow, then that is a lot of damage on the table that he's going to be looking to dish out. And he did exactly that. Now, last time we saw him hesitate before going back to Geras. Oh, this is a surprise.
Interesting.
Okay, so it looks like he's... Is that not the same variation twice? Shoulder charge. No, okay, so this... Okay, this one has the super jump. Right, so Cassie is another character that, thanks to custom variations, has got a lot of options now, but we haven't seen them all. This one is a full screen launcher shot. You have the flying glow kick, which is a very Johnny Cage style, just shadow kick, but for her, it's an armor break. And the super jump, the advancing BLB, which is literally just she jumps forward, like leaps forward, and that's it, or leaps back. Very good for mobility. Very dangerous indeed. Now, against Spawn, I mean, this is going to have to be a three-game comeback. Now, the good thing is it's a super jump that doesn't cost resources. That's the big thing about it.
Well, I mean, Titanium Tigers also has a secondary set to work with, too, so if Cassie doesn't end up bringing out here, it's at the very least okay for them. Oh, big damage right there. Restand.
Oh my goodness.
It just goes for the down one, yeah. So much like versus iScorpion, recognized that he was pressing buttons and just, you know, went for the guaranteed down one damage.
Okay, there's another hit, but the breakaway from Unjust does not want to give Tigers the chance to bring this match back. Now, that full screen game, however, kneecapping is going to beat... Oh, never mind. Kneecapping will beat the normal shot, but it is very minus on block. Now this is reset point now for Mighty Unjust. He is hungry for that tournament win. He wants to reset the bracket and he wants to do it quickly.
He's definitely poised to do it right now. He is dealing with these gunshots fairly well. Okay, finally getting knocked back, however. Oh, jumped into the amplify.
Oh, punish. A lot of recovery on that. Oh,
yeah, there's that advance. Yeah, just keep doing it. Trying to force Mighty Unjust to do something and then maybe, you know, get a gunshot in or two.
Decent amount of chip.
I do love the patience here from Titanium Tigers, though. He's just recognizing exactly when he can press buttons. He's not taking any risks, and then he backs off if he can't get anything more. Great breakaway. He's going to take too much damage from that.
Oh, hello. Let's go for the restand. Again, that forward dash, back dash, really trying to bait out a button from Tigers. Okay. I like the way Tigers have slowed this down. Really not afraid to just play this one patient. Oh! Why, as I say that though, a super jump forward, but can afford to do it.
Yeah, we were now both commending Titanium Tiger's patience, and then eventually, at the very end, completely switched it up 180. And I mean, that's one of those things that your opponent's not expecting. You play an entire two rounds completely patient, hardly advancing, and then, you know, at the very end, you advance. They're not ready for that.
It definitely is a bit of a style change. Oh no! Unfortunate drop for Unjust though. Doesn't convert into something that will work. Oh, the last bullet missed there too. Whip! Oh, no punish at all actually. Okay, this is a very puzzling end of this game. Plus frames or walk back.
Yeah, plus frames only matter if you keep pressing buttons afterwards. But okay, gonna get the launch. Big damage there.
Oh, hang on, Unjust. Walking into a lot of damage here. Again, there's that jump.
Yeah. Oh, and then the low shot.
Unjust was definitely eager to close the gap a bit too much there, I think. However, I want to say, we have to remember now, we know Unjust, he's been playing a lot of Spawn, and last time I said this, he just stuck with Spawn anyway. But we have to look at the possibilities now. He is up 2-1, and this is the last character that Titanium Tigers can use in this set. Now, if the bracket is reset, that does count as a new set, and Unjust will be able to change characters even if he wins this next match. However, because he's up 2-1, we know that Tigers is stuck with the Cassie now, and this specific variation at that. And Cassie is a character that does have some trouble matchups. She definitely does have some picks that aren't great for her. So this could be a situation we'll see Unjust go to one, because he is the kind of player to do that. But it looks like, again, another time we would expect to see him change, because it's definitely the time that Unjust would change previously. He's actually looking to stick with Spawn. So he really wants to stick it out with the Spawn today. for the rest of this tournament. And, you know, I respect that, because this is a character he's played before, but not to this degree, but clearly he's been putting a lot of time into this character.
This could also be, like, a long road type decision for Mighty Unjust, like, seeing how Spawn fares again in the meta of custom variations and things like that, you know? Seeing if he can stick it out through that with this character. Just, it could just legitimately be a data thing, or maybe this is the most comfortable he's ever felt. It just,
I mean, this is far from the first time we've seen him in Open Series, and will be far from the last, I have no doubt. So that definitely is a possibility.
And it is also only week one. You know, there's going to be more of Mighty Unjust picking other characters, I'm sure.
We do have cups all the way the rest through December. Oh, but then evade. Dash up grab again. I feel like Tigers is actually not really playing a very buttons-focused neutral with Cassie. It's much more about specials. It's more about kind of just leap into gun or whatever it may be, a glow kick.
I feel like that's the Cetrion player within Titanium Tigers, right?
Definitely seems it. You can see the similarities for sure. Deep jump kick, but again, Tigers is not being too disrespectful. Oh, the dash up grab again. The more respectful you are, the more prone you are to being thrown. You cannot tech throws if you're blocking. Ooh.
Got him out of the air. Yeah, I was trying to get the shadow kick that time, but no dice. Gets the throw escape. Oh, yeah, that's a punish.
Catch. And that's it. Unjust is one round away. This is reset point again. So the biggest problem for Tigers is look where he is, this corner. Oh, no. Not a great place to be. The dash up. When enough dash up grabs has worked. Dash up mid. Oh, my goodness.
Say not a great place to be, but this is where he's been the entire match. He's been nowhere else, and he's just taking chip damage.
Oh,
yeah, eventually something's gonna finish it off with a flawless victory on the reset. Mighty Unjust.
Flawless victory into that pose, onto that throne. That's the flawless throne. You know what? Considering Unjust is so known for friendships, I am actually disgusted that he missed a prime opportunity to go for a legitimate friendship. You know, the requirement for doing a friendship is to just not block in the winning round. So you can basically equate that to not taking chip damage, and you can do a friendship. So if you get a flawless, you can probably friendship. He does so many friendships, but so little real friendships. Because you can bypass it by using easy fatality tokens. And that's not real, but we get to see it, so I appreciate it. But that was an opportunity to do a real one. Now the question is, do we see a change? Because Tigers did go to Cassie when he was... metaphorically backed against the wall, and then ended up backed against the wall. Now, Kotal, this is much more of a familiar character, but he's thinking about it. He definitely has not made up his mind yet.
Yeah, well, you had mentioned previously the number of characters that Titanium Tigers can play. You know, pretty much the rogue gallery is gigantic, right? So, okay, it looks like it's the Cetrion, which is kind of the staple character for Titanium Tigers, as we feel. Or at least as I feel.
I would definitely say it's become one of them for him. I don't really know too much about before. I feel like whenever I'd see Tigers, it would be a lot of Jade, a lot of Kotal, a lot of different characters, but Cetrion was one of them, but not any more than I would say others. But since Customs, it would not surprise me if he's been putting a lot more time into her because of this variation. It's so strong. And also the first time he's played it against Unjust.
I just remember when MK11 first dropped, I remember there were two players that played both Jade and Cetrion in Oregon, and Titanium Tigers was one of them, so.
There actually was quite a lot of crossover between Jade and Cetrion players. I think they both kind of ticked a lot of the same boxes early on. You know, same kind of archetype, pretty slow pace compared to a lot of the cast, but a big crushing blow.
Every time I see it, my heart winces a little bit.
Oh, the punish on the roll, however.
You get great damage off that. Here's the restand. Okay, yeah, trying to go for the big stuff. Maybe trying to catch a backdash. I know Titanium Tigers loves backdashing, right? Obviously because, you know, it helps with the zoning stuff. It helps with punishing. But no dice on that one.
Oh, hello. No, that could have been death. Oh, no, but the swift stab of the chain.
That's a heartbreaker, for sure.
Yeah, it's not a great way for that to end if you're Tigers, unfortunately. But it's like I said before, he's very slippery, right? He doesn't really like sitting there and having to deal with opponents' like offense. So he will backdash a lot of holding up back and wake up rolls. But a spawn standing three is good for whiff punishing a lot of them. Now this first game on the reset is going to be so important. Because when you've got players that are willing to change, maybe not as much Unjust today, but as a general thing, getting that, even if it's one game advantage, to make counterpicking that even one bit harder. Don't want to lose this, and Unjustice poised very well for taking this.
Well, I mean, right now he's having a lot of trouble dealing with not only the ground pound, but the rock toss. Finally finding the change-up in Titanium Tiger's zoning game plan. Okay, there's the port. Ooh, got the ground pound there. Yeah, I mean, he's got Fatal Blow. I wonder if it's going to become a factor if he thinks that the projectile is going to come. And I think that's probably why you don't see it from Mighty Unjust, and you see a lot more forward dashes, is because he's too worried about it. But now it's completely gone to his favor. He avoided the chip, though.
Oh, the empty jump grab, but that's going to push her at a distance. Ah, the charge. Really calling out something big there. The longer he stayed full screen, the more he'd have to worry about boulders being hard to avoid, the mind game of air boulder or ground one. Ground pound, of course, the earthquake. One just did have the lead there, but the longer he was spent at distance. Ooh, got underneath. Oh, hello. You see, again, Tigers, he hits that up three and uses the time to move away. No interest in playing point blank.
Ooh, wow, that's the first time we've seen the glide for anything but a combo.
Indeed. Oh, max range charge.
No full conversion off that punish, though.
That's a lot of damage left. I mean, maybe not for Cetron, but enough. Oh, but there's the air boulder.
Yeah, meaty boulder into the ground pound. It's just been super difficult right now. And oh, what a great reaction there on the jump.
On the preemptive button, he knows. He knows. In the first game of the reset, going to Titanium Tigers. So we are definitely not finished. This change to Cetron making a lot of difference here. As Spawn, this is not the first time we've seen Spawn struggle against Cetron in the Open Series. Definitely a matchup that seems to be the ever chasing, right? You do a lot of damage when you get the hit. Your projectile's not bad, but you have that slow recovery. You will spend most of the game chasing after it.
It seemed like Titanium Tigers was really preying upon the fact that the Mighty Unjust really loves that Spawn forward dash. I mean, I understand that it's fantastic, don't get me wrong, but he was forward dashing into a ton of the ground pounds, and then there was one point where it was like, it was kind of a check situation where he was probably too worried about throwing a projectile because of the Fatal Blow, being able to catch him. And then, so he would forward dash, and then Titanium Tigers just preyed upon that and got so much extra damage. I like the noob Psybot because of the teleport. I feel like it's, it makes so much sense.
I mean, you can teleport the boulder, you can teleport if you see her go into the air to go for the beam, like, you have options. And on the ground, when you're forced to that kind of, like, you know, real footsies range, you've got 4-2, down 4, good anti-air, like, you have a lot. And the slide is not even a bad projectile by itself to really go for the trades or just do a decent chunk of damage by itself. And like I said, this has definitely been a variation that has been Unjust's kind of like comfort go-to. So not surprised to see it here at all.
Let's see how it goes. I think at this point we're in the comfort zone for both players here, and I don't know if this is going to be a very comfortable matchup, however, for Titanium Tigers because of the options that Noob Saibot presents. Okay, miss on that, but we're gonna throw him in the corner.
I think he tries to go for the back one grab string, which is a really good conversion tool, but he just got the grab, so he must have mistimed it.
Yeah, I just did it a bit too early, maybe. Oh, there one, nice. Yeah, that was such a good block. But unfortunately, his teleport's not gonna come to fruition, and in fact, gonna hurt him much more.
Very unfortunate miss there from Unjust. Dash up block. Oh. Tries to interrupt with that tornado. The chip damage is adding up.
Oh, okay. Ooh, that was real scary. I thought for a second that connected.
You can never be too sure with Noob. Noob's Fatal Blow, one of the stronger in the game for sure, but can kind of just come out of nowhere. Round guy, the Titanium Tigers. Oh, hello.
Big damage on this one for sure. 251. Ooh, I think caught the backdash again. I mean, that's kind of been a staple for Titanium Tigers. Backdash, gain that space, be able to do something like that, right? So.
Oh. Tries to wake up with the big punish. Oh, lets the ground pound rock. No cancel.
I was maybe looking to catch him trying to move forward or press a button. Oh, caught the interactable jump.
Tigers very close to being up two games, but that was a decent chunk. Oh, Fatal Blow response. Unjust finds it.
That's something that normally Cetrion only has the ability to do versus a lot of people. Is, you know, that Fatal Blow is a whiff punish when you're like far away from them, but Cetrion has to worry about it when it's versus Noob Saibot.
I mean, there are a few characters in the game that have long range or just straight up like projectile fatal blows, but they are the ones that tend to really benefit the most, right? The fact that fatal blows, they come back, you know, about 9 seconds or so after being used, but there it is, the reaction. Ooh, knowing the breakaway's coming.
Yeah, it would have been a lot of damage for Titanium Tigers to have to make up, so I understand the breakaway for sure.
But when you are playing against another character that has those long-range fatal blows, it's just, it's that thing you have to respect that you don't normally have to. But yeah, you have to respect it once, as it did work and win the round, but it is gone now. Tiger still has his to use.
Ground pound putting in a lot of mileage. Okay. You know, he's been real good about being patient enough to wait for those options. Unfortunately, he didn't punish the teleport very well, but I'm surprised at how much the patience is paying off in terms of being able to block. It feels like Mighty just knows that he's going to sit there and block, but he still goes to those things anyway.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those brick wall matchups, though. Both players very defense heavy. So important about the life lead. Oh, that chip damage could be a big problem. Oh, and there it is, the Hell's Wrath. And the fatal, there is the fatal blow. We see it now. But that does mean that even though that was a well-fought game number two of the reset, that does mean that Tigers is up 2-0. And I will say, this is also the same exact variation that Unjust has lost to Ice Scorpion using a few times since the custom patch. So I think this Cetrion specifically, this variation, has become a bit of a pain in the backside for Unjust. He just hasn't really been able to find that kind of go-to answer that he normally has been able to for pretty much every other character in the game, really. He really is one of those players that will look at who you've picked, will look at his entire kind of roster of characters, and pick accordingly. You know, whether it's a counter pick, whether it's him just feeling way better about fighting them, he just hasn't really been able to do that for the Cetrion yet, and he's fought it pretty much every tournament since we've seen customs become the norm. So I'm just still in the process of trying to find that answer, but Tiger's really running away with this one. We had such a nail biter of a game 5 reset, but, and there it is, we're going back to spawn. And this is officially what Unjust is locked into. And yeah, you know, I like this pick because he's used this pick to defeat. He's beat multiple of Tiger's characters with this, so he knows that he doesn't have to worry about winning one game and then Tiger's just changing to beat that instead. If he can take out the Cetrion with this spawn, then that's going to help him a lot.
We were also talking about the spawn pick in previous sets where we were unsure if it was enough to be able to take out some of the other people's characters, right? Because it seemed like some of the other players were starting to figure out the spawn pick. And then Mighty just stuck with it anyway, despite the fact that we thought, oh, okay, it's counterpick time, right? That didn't end up actually happening. He stuck with spawn and he still made it happen. So if anybody's going to do it, it's probably the spawn, right? Because even though bad matchups are can be there, it hasn't exactly phased Mighty Unjust throughout the rest of this
match. No, I mean, I really do feel like, and you know, I'm not going to say something so bold as to bad matchups don't exist, but like, I feel like with the inclusion of customs and players really sticking to their guns with characters, we're seeing unwinnable matchups, like, rarely ever. Like, yeah, we're seeing 6-4s, we're seeing, like, slight advantage here and there, but to the point that you would never pick this character competitively against other said character, we're not really seeing that, like, least of all now, and I really like that. However, yeah. Tigers, that full screen game again, or not even the full screen, but just the control of the neutral, quite a pain.
You mentioned the run-up throw being incredibly strong right now. Unfortunately, it's not going to be enough damage, but run-up throw has gotten a lot of mileage for Mighty Unjust because, just like you said, if you're already holding block, you cannot tech the throw. Fight.
And then you see run-up button, run-up standing 3 out of range, run-up 4-4 for that fast little shin kick. Definitely there. Oh, speaking of which, big damage. Hello, 330. Yep. Ooh, good throw tech. Tiger's down on tournament point, though. A kind of important thing. He wins this round, that's it, it's over. He has invaded the Open Series, taken out the 3 most notable players in North America in it. In one go. Unjust is not letting that happen, not yet.
Yeah, well, Fatal Blow is available for Titanium Tigers, but the...
Ooh, the breakaway! Three. Yeah, Tigers wants to take this round right here, he does not want to lose this.
Well, if he does, he's going to have no defensive bar to work with, and that's exactly how it is. He's going to get a little bit of it back in between the death animation, but it's going to be hard right now.
Like, no, I actually feel like Tigers froze up there, because he did a breakaway at a very bold time, but what followed was anything but. He really froze up, letting Unjust go for, like, button, you know, down one on block, into standing 3, like, frame data is not on his side there, but it will be if Tigers lets it happen. Oh, there's a punish, hang on a minute, Tigers. He is very close to winning this tournament, but his gameplay has definitely changed because of it. Can he fight back? I suppose the bar on that too.
Point right now, so despite the small life deficit, it's still looking pretty because the second he gets away, just like he has right now, it's gonna be difficult. He's navigating these projectile decisions a lot better right now, but unfortunately for him, Titanium Tigers is ready with the crushing blow.
Oh, when it comes down to the boulder, Titanium Tigers, absolute stellar performance. Not only makes his open series debut, takes out Biohazard, Mighty Unjust, Ice Scorpion, and then Mighty Unjust again in the grand finals to become the winner of December. The first winner of December, his first championship and a $250 prize secured. GG's Titanium Tigers, thank you for playing. And of course, GG's to Unjust as well for being able to get that win against Ice Scorpion, really reigniting that rivalry between them. And overall, putting on a good show. This was a fun tournament, but I do say so myself. Oh,
absolutely, I completely agree. Just as an outsider, like, I can say that for sure. But like, if this is only week one, so you guys got to remember that. But this is only the first week of the month of December, so we could be seeing, you know, people try to take out Titanium Tigers a little bit later, or we can, you know, see maybe that run back of a matchup with Ice Scorpion and Mighty Unjust again some more. We see the evolutions, because when you play week after week, you do not want to get stomped again a second time, right? You want to make that name travel far. You want to be able to get back on your horse, if you will.
I mean, of course, especially when you're a player like Unjust, right, and you've been here as many times as you have, and you know, you kind of lose that success over a few weeks. You want to be able to kind of, you know, bring yourself back to it. But this is definitely the day of Titanium Tigers. I mean, you can really see for yourself: 3-0 over Bio, 3-1 over Unjust, 3-2 over Ice Scorpion, and then we did see the bracket reset thanks to Unjust, but then that changed to Cetrion for the 3-0. Very much an impressive showing no matter what. But it is like you said, this was merely week number one for December. We are going into the seventh month of Open Series tournaments for Mortal Kombat 11. There has been a lot to watch, and we are not done just yet. We do have more coming up, but not only MK11, I do want to show you that we have other fighting games in the Open Series as well, as I'm sure Ebonic Play can tell us all about what's going on tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow you guys can catch Soul Calibur 6, which just recently had a big patch going down, so you guys are going to see a lot of different stuff going on. You can watch it here on these channels that you're watching right now. Remember, for EU, that's at 9 a.m. PT, and for NA, it's 2 p.m. PT. That's the North American side for those, I believe. But yeah, so you guys will catch me tomorrow for that, if you know, that's what you care about, I guess.
But, hey, man, you made MK better tonight, so I'm sure you do the same thing for Soul Calibur. But I do as well. You know, want to extend another huge thanks to Ebonic, because, you know, in this crazy world of online commentary, there are moments where sometimes you just might become unavailable. And it's always nice when people are willing to kind of like step up, and especially for these shows, they could be quite long. I don't know what time it is where you live, but you know, it's very late here in the UK. We're coming up about 2 a.m. So doing a 3-4 hour show at that last minute notice can be you know, quite surprising to a lot of people. But you know, you really helped out today, and I really do appreciate you joining us for it. And I do hope those of you watching at home will join us for Soul Calibur 6 tomorrow for the monthly finals. I know I'll be watching, I'll be having a lot of fun with it and cheering on the EU boys. But unfortunately, my friends, that is all we have time for today overall. I would like to extend again another huge thanks to you, Ebonic, for coming in and really, you know, being the anytime man, for being the saving grace today. I want to have a huge thanks to the players, of course, for putting on a great show today. To those of you watching at home, whether it's on Twitch, whether it's YouTube, thank you so much for giving us your evening. We do hope you had fun. Of course, a thanks to Sony and PlayStation for putting on these events in the first place for the community. We really do appreciate it. And last but certainly not least, the production crew for putting in all that time behind the scenes to make the show run smoothly. Do you have anything you want to say before we close out the night?
Hey, just thank you so much to all the players and everything, and thank you so much everybody who you know, participated in the Open Series. Those matches were phenomenal. I had a super fun time, and you know, I can't wait for you guys to be able to see Ketchup and Mustard back in action the next time the Open Series is here. But yeah, so stay tuned for that, guys. Thank you so much.
Well, that does mean I think it's time to call it a day. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us. You do have yourselves a pleasant evening. We'll see you tomorrow on this Twitch for the Soul Calibur 6 monthly finals. And we'll see you next Tuesday for the continuation of Mortal Kombat 11 in the Open Series. Peace out. Take care of yourselves. And we'll see you then.